baseball game of the spring on the Rev Game of the Week. My name is Jeff Porsche, and along with Mike Moeller, we welcome you to tonight's non-district matchup between the visiting Hahnville Tigers and the Dutchtown Griffins. When we return, we will talk about tonight's matchup with Mike, and we will have Hahnville's starting lineup followed by the first pitch here on the Rev Game of the Week.
Your business is as unique as Southeast Louisiana. People, culture, family. We know what it means to be local. Rev is the only communications provider with support teams that live and work in the same Louisiana communities that we serve. Customer-first localism is truly in our DNA. Our promise is to bring your business the reliability and local support you deserve. We've been connecting communities in Louisiana for 85 years, and we're ready to serve you and your business. Rev Business.
B.T. Chapman and A.J. Pickett with Advantage Therapy are honored and excited to team up with Dutchtown High School's athletics. At Advantage Therapy, we are dedicated to helping our patients regain the highest possible functional status through one-on-one patient care. Advantage Therapy has spent nearly two decades providing both outpatient orthopedic physical therapy and occupational therapy to the people of Ascension and surrounding parishes. From all of us at Advantage Therapy, go Griffins!
It's game day at Raising Cane's. If you want to order like a champ, forget about X's and O's. The only play you're running is chicken. So what combo are you picking? We've got tailgates of hand-battered, cooked-to-order chicken fingers and cane sauce. Touchdown! And jugs of freshly made tea and lemonade. This season is about to be unbeatable. Raising Cane's Chicken Fingers. One love.
Dr. Brian Hollis is Ascension Parish's orthodontist. Dr. Hollis has an excellent reputation for bringing state-of-the-art technology and the highest standard of patient care to Ascension. He attended LSU, LSU Dental School, and he completed a residency to become a board-certified specialist in orthodontics. An avid supporter in our community, Dr. Hollis is married to Celeste Pyra Hollis, and they have four children. Dr. Hollis, Ascension Parish's orthodontist. Grow up smiling with Hollis Orthodontics.
Get to know SEC Heating and Cooling this year. Locally owned and operated by Stephen Conyer since 2013, SEC Heating and Cooling works with residential and commercial customers in Ascension, East Baton Rouge, Livingston, and surrounding parishes. SEC specializes in preventive maintenance, repair, and complete changeout and installation of energy-efficient central air systems. From professional sales and expert installation of central AC systems to repairs and ductless AC systems, we can handle all your needs. For total peace of mind, call SEC today.
No one teaches you what to do immediately after an accident. Once everyone is safe, your first call should be to an attorney, not the insurance company.
Don't let the insurance company take advantage of you at your time of need. Call the Tuttle Law Firm. We'll walk you through what you need to do in real time.
But you can take advantage of the Tuttle Law Firm's 30 years of experience.
Before you call your insurance, make a free, no obligation call to the Tuttle Law Firm.
Call 756-0007 when you're injured. You gotta call Tuttle.
Looking for an extraordinary education opportunity? Introducing Ascension Public Schools Early College Option Program, where you can earn a high school diploma and an associate's degree from River Parish's Community College at the same time. Experience the best of both worlds as high school seamlessly blends with college coursework in a rigorous yet supportive program. Yet stay connected to your home high school through clubs, organizations, and sports. And here's the best part. Students pay no tuition or textbook costs. Ascension Public Schools Early College Option Program, where your future begins today.
As a local provider, we understand the unique challenges and rewards as a Southeast Louisiana business. And we're right here with you, powering your business with local know-how and the unmatched service you deserve. Our internet and managed services are more than connectivity. They're our promise to provide the most important thing every business needs, consistency and quality. We're here to help. For a limited time, get 3 months free. Rev Business. Visit us at letsrev.biz.
Welcome back to the Rev Game of the Week. And as you can see from our shot, we are at Dutchtown High School, Griffin Field, home of the Dutchtown Griffins. I'm Jeff Porsche, and Mike Moeller is with me here tonight for our spring debut for high school baseball, as our game of the week, Hahnville, versus Dutchtown. And when you look at the two teams so far this season, still a very young season. Really the first weekend of high school baseball was last weekend, and Hahnville is 1-3 on the season. Dutchtown is off to a hot start. They are 5-0, and when you look at the two coaches, got a new coach at Hahnville, Mike. It's Jared Vial. He replaces David Beaudry, who has been at Hahnville for a very long time, so they're still getting a new program together. But at Dutchtown, it's the same old thing. It's Chris Shakesnyder, who's been here in some capacity from the start and has 383 overall wins and a bunch of district games and a bunch of playoff wins and just a lot of accolades.
Yeah, you mentioned Coach Vial. I mean, he coming in, he starts out 1-3, but like you said, we're in the infant stages of the season here. So, I mean, you know, there's plenty of time for this team to gel. We're used to, you know, Coach Beaudry being here. We've seen him multiple times
right
here over the past couple of years, but I'm sure Vial will continue that that legacy over there for Hahnville. And as for Chris Shakesnyder, like you said, started here at the inception of the school back in 03, 04-ish, I think, as an assistant to Coach Mike Tukes, and then took over 17 years ago, and he's had quite the resume with those 383 wins.
And so you see the graphic right there, Coach Shakesnyder, and he's out there in the back. He's the one with all the baseballs right there. So talking it over with his assistant coaches, and he's an institution. He's taken this team to a state final. He's taken the team to Sulphur as recently as 2 years ago, and he's looking to have a bounce-back season. Got to the second round last year, to the regional round, was ousted by Live Oak, and he says he's got a good chance this year. Team's kind of young, replacing a bunch of players, but he said this team's going to improve as the year goes along.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen them for so long. I mean, I think I've been doing this for 10 years plus or whatever now. And, you know, when you see Dutchtown, you always think, oh, they're going to lose a lot of players. But they don't really have to ever regroup. They just kind of rebuild. You know, there's always some. I mean, if you look at their roster this year, there's six or so sophomores that are already, you know, getting a little bit of experience on this varsity field. And those are the guys in a couple of years, you know, that are going to carry that torch. And that's kind of what you just see, you know, over the history of watching these Griffins.
And they've had a very solid start to this season. As you saw earlier, they're 5-0, and they've played some pretty good teams. The one that really stands out, they had a couple of games this weekend. They beat St. Michael's by a score of 3-1, but the one that really raised some eyebrows was a win on Saturday against Hewitt-Trussville, school out of Alabama, and they are one of the best teams in the state of Alabama. They have two SEC commits in their starting lineup, and Dutchtown beat them by a score of 5-3. Now, we heard that they committed a bunch of errors in that game, and that kind of helped Dutchtown out, but a win's a win in a situation like that.
Yeah, especially early on. I mean, you have all these tournaments. I think you have three more tournaments coming up the next three weekends. You're talking about, like, using a lot of arms. I mean, just the split, maybe go 3-1 in those four-game series over the weekend is outstanding. Dutchtown goes 4-0 unscathed over the weekend. That's a great start.
Absolutely. And their other wins are over U-High. Of course, U-High has always got a great program. Vanderbilt Catholic, they won state a couple of years ago, and then they've also defeated St. Thomas Aquinas. Now, Hahnville, we talked about them being 1-3, and, you know, they got the new coach, Vial, but really it's not really unknown how good they are at this point because, again, Mike, you talked about it. The season's young, and three of their four games were against Sam Houston, and that's one of the top programs, a team that's in Sulphur all the time, and they lost 2 out of 3, but they did win one of the three games.
Yeah, and I mean, they won the last of the three, right? So that
right.
kind of tells me they have a little bit of depth, right? Because Sam
right.
Houston, one of the powerhouses in the state, you have to believe that they're pretty deep pitching-wise, and when you get to game three, you know, you're down the line a little bit of ways, and for Hahnville to come out, I think they even shut them out maybe game three?
It was 2-0.
Yeah, 2-0 right there. So, I mean, that tells me Hahnville is pretty deep as well, so they're not to be taken lightly.
Right. You saw the two coaches right there, Vial and Shakesnyder, and then we got the nice ground shot of the Dutchtown Griffins as they get ready to take the field, and we're going to get to the national anthem, and then we'll get to the starting lineups.
Ceremony. We ask that everybody please rise and remove your caps for the playing of our national anthem.
And please remember those men and women, both past and present, who serve in our military. Without their sacrifices, we couldn't enjoy the freedoms we have today.
We have the national anthem, and now we are ready to go. Dutchtown has taken the field, and they'll get to their warm-up pitches in just a moment. But while we wait for that to happen, I'm going to turn it over to Mike, and Mike's going to give us the batting order for the visitors, Hondville Tigers.
Yeah, leading off today for the Tigers is going to be the catcher, Truman Moyer, hitting second to left fielder, Caleb Grisco. Batting third, Tyler Terrio, the shortstop. Hitting cleanup, the second baseman, Ryan Gregson. The center fielder, Chase Morales, bats fifth. Hitting sixth, Bo Parker, and he'll play first base. The right fielder, Toa Romero, hits seventh. In the eight hole, Jacob Howden will be on the pitcher's mound today. And hitting ninth, the third baseman, Jacob Jetter.
And so they will face one of the veteran starting pitchers for Dutchtown, as they're going to start number nine, Jordan Oberle. He's a right-handed pitcher, and he's got a lot of experience, and we've seen him pitch multiple times over the years, Mike.
Yeah, we have. And I mean, he, like you said, experience is huge. I mean, we've seen him multiple times last year. You saw him a little bit, maybe as a sophomore. Going to fill up the strike zone, loves his breaking ball, throws at him. Any count for strikes, I mean, just tough to square up. Loves to change speeds, pitches backwards sometimes, but he will keep the Griffins in the game.
So we got maybe one or two warmer pitches left to go, and then we'll get to the first batter for Hondville. One thing I want to point out tonight, it's not supposed to rain tonight. It's very cloudy, especially out toward the left and center field. But the rain's supposed to come in tomorrow, and it's supposed to get cooler, but it should make it through the night. And it's in the low 70s this evening, very humid. But one thing that we got to notice, if we get a shot of the flags a little bit later, the wind is howling out to left field, 15-plus miles an hour. So anything that gets up in a jet stream off of a right-handed hitter has a chance of getting out the park.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the wind could play a factor tonight. I mean, all day it's been blowing pretty stiff here, and you just look at the flags out there, and they look like their starts just pointed out towards that left center gap.
And so we are now ready to go, and it's going to be Moyer, Grisco, and Terrio, 1, 2, and 3 for the Hondville Tigers. And spring sports now underway, and a bouncer to second base, and that's picked up, and a throw to first for the out, Kobe Mitchell, to Dylan DeSherry for the first out. And with one out, we're going to go to the defensive starters for the Dutchtown Griffins.
Yeah, defensively today for Dutchtown in the outfield from left to right, we have Carter Hanbury, Logan Mayu, Caleb Wall. On the infield, third base, Ethan Oquan. Shortstop is Casey McCoy. At second base, Kobe Mitchell. At first, Dylan DeSherry. The batter today for the Griffins, behind the dish, Dylan Champagne. On the mound, Jordan Oberle.
And Oberle facing Grisco, who is left fielder tonight for the Tigers. And the first pitch is a ball low and inside. So the count 1-0. The third pitch of the night for Oberle is a strike. And even to count 1-1.
Yeah, a little breaking ball right there. I mean, what hitter's looking, you know, 1-0, you don't look breaking ball right there. And that's kind of what I touched on a little bit earlier. He's going to throw that breaking ball at any count, so don't be surprised when you see it.
And that's hit hard to left, but just taking a couple of steps right to Caleb Wall for the second out. So Garisco with a hard fly ball to right field for the second out, and good start for Oberlin.
That's a pitch you want to be a little careful with. I think that was a breaking ball, like down and into those lefties. You want to kind of be careful with those balls down there, those left-handed hitters. That's kind of like their happy zone. They like to drop the head on the bat. I mean, the head on the ball right there, and they usually get pretty good contact, as you saw there.
We now have the shortstop today, Talenterio, who is the third batter for Hahnville, hitting from the right side. 1-0 pitch, and there's a strike on the outside corner, even to count. Two outs. And the top of the first, no score, Hahnville versus Dutchtown. Jordan Oberle offers, and the breaking ball does not break soon enough, and it's high for ball two.
Yeah, just tried to crank on that one a little bit too much. You see, he kind of tried to throw that a little bit early, kind of in launch mode right there. That's when you kind of feel like you're going to throw that grenade.
And there's one a little high. And so now behind for the first time, 3-1. Only threw one pitch to the leadoff hitter, threw three to the second hitter, and now this is going to be his fifth offering to Terrio. 3-1, two outs, top of the first. And that's fouled away over to the track meet. The junior high, middle school, whatever you want to call it, track meet going on at Griffin Field this afternoon. Hard to get a parking space out here.
Yeah, I didn't know what was going on. I thought the World Series or something when you pulled up over here.
So now the full count, 3-2 pitch. And a foul tip into the glove of the catcher, Dylan Champagne, for the third out. Strikeout, no runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left. And so now we go to the bottom of the first. Hahnville doesn't score. Dutchtown coming to the plate. And Mike will give you the batting order for the Dutchtown Griffins.
Leading off for the Griffins today, the shortstop, Casey McCoy. Hitting second is Kobe Mitchell. He's the second baseman. Hitting third, the left fielder, Carter Henberry. And in the cleanup spot, the first baseman, Dylan DeSherry. Hitting fifth is the catcher, Dylan Champagne. The DH, Andrew Fields, hits sixth. In the seven hole, Caleb Wall, and he'll play right field. The third baseman, Ethan Oakland, hits eighth. And hitting ninth, Logan Mayer, and he'll play center field.
And so some veterans, some new faces in Dutchtown's starting lineup, and they're going to face right-handed pitcher for Hahnville. That's Jacob Hayden, number seven, for the Tigers. See him getting ready as get a good look at him. And warm-up's coming, but really the guy that you want to look for, the kind of the straw that stirs the drink, is going to be the leadoff hitter for Dutchtown. That's Casey McCoy. He's a junior at shortstop. He's already committed to be a Raging Cajun in 2 years. So he's a good player and really one of the leaders of this Dutchtown baseball team.
Yeah, we saw him a good bit last year. He kind of bursted on the scene as a sophomore and kind of took everybody by surprise. I don't want to say took everybody by surprise, but I mean, you come in, you lead off hitting as a sophomore, at an institution as, as big as Dutchtown. I mean, you got to have some game, and he just showed, man, he was up for the task. He aggressive, offensively and defensively. Never really saw him make too many mistakes. So I'm sure he's just getting better from there.
Absolutely. And when you saw the batting order, if you've been following Dutchtown or watching our Rev broadcast, you're going to see a lot of those names look very familiar, as the majority of the starters on the baseball team are also starters on the Griffin football team. And so that's something that we'll point out whenever we get to them. And this is one of the receivers and punters for Dutchtown, and the shortstop, Casey McCoy, leading off for the Griffins. And he wanted to offer, but takes a strike.
I think Jacob Hayden got the memo. That's a first pitch breaking ball right there. He's not going to give in early. He knows Casey McCoy wants to ambush that first fastball he sees.
Absolutely, but he's filling the strike zone early.
Yeah, doubled up, another breaking ball.
Interesting. So now McCoy's going to call for time. He might be a little out of sorts right there with the pitch count.
Decision right there. I mean, before you even catch your breath, you're 0-2. So that's good by him. Take a step out of the box and catch your breath, kind of regroup.
And takes the third pitch in the dirt outside. 1-2. And that one just outside. 2-2, leadoff hitter. Bottom of the first for Dutchtown, no score. Hahnville versus the Griffins. Hayden getting ready. Taking his time, and we're going to get time. Looks like we're ready to go again. And the windup and the offering is low, a little below the knees, and the count is full. So can't find a strike zone after those first two breaking balls.
Kind of like that by Hyde. Kind of paused right there, kind of shook off a couple times. Typically, that's going to, you're going to shake to a breaking ball after you see a couple shakes. See, there's a shake there, taking his time. You always think he's going to go to the breaking ball, but this is just down with the last two fastballs.
And so a walk after an 0-2 count. And so he's on first base, and with the second hitter coming up, let's go to the defensive starters for Hahnville.
Yeah, so today, defensively for the Tigers in the outfield left to right, we're going to have Caleb Barisco, Chase Morales, and Cole Romero on the infield. Third base, Jacob Jeffrey. Shortstop, Tyler Terrio at second. Ryan Gregson, the first baseman, is Bo Parker. Behind the dish, Truman Moyer, and on the bump, Jacob Hayden.
And now, first pitch is low to Kobe Mitchell, the second baseman for the Griffins. McCoy with the first at bat gets a base on balls. He's got a lead at first.
Yeah, a couple of those last three or four pitches look pretty close. That pitch in particular.
Right.
Unless it just missed.
And there's a bouncer into the hole. Just past the first baseman. McCoy's going to third, and he's going to slide. Out of runner going to second. And runners on second and third. After the base hit, the seeing eye single by Kobe Mitchell, and good start for the Griffins.
Yeah, it looked like a little hit and run right there. I think Casey McCoy might have started a little early off of the bag right there.
Now batting for the Griffins.
Kind of drew the infielders in, left the hole over there. See the first baseman, Bo Parker, made a good effort just outside of his reach.
Carter Hanbury to the plate. The runners on second and third, an RBI opportunity. Infield playing in already. No outs. Bottom of the first. Hanbury takes a strike on that outside corner. Mitchell at second, McCoy at third. Now the shortstop drops back. And the second baseman drops back. And the breaking ball misses just a little bit outside.
That's a good take right there by Hanbury. You see that first fastball, Hayden paints on the outside corner for a strike, and then he starts that breaking ball in the exact same spot. Hanbury doesn't even flinch.
Hanbury, one of those names that Dutchtown Griffin football fans are definitely familiar with. And there's a bouncer to short, and they're going to go to third, tag, and he's out. So the run scores. Casey McCoy gets the first run of the game, but the tag at third gets Mitchell, and Hanbury is safe on the fielder's choice.
Now batting for the
Griffin. Yeah, good job by Hanbury right there. Outs right there. You've got to put the ball in play with the runner at third base. Try to get one across the board there, and he did just that. Unfortunately, they got that lead runner, Mitchell, there at third base, which still leaves Hanbury at first.
And now Dylan DeSherry, the first baseman for Dutchtown, takes a strike. So Dutchtown strikes first on the grounder by Hanbury. It's 1-0, and now DeSherry is behind in the count 0-2. Again, Hanbury at first, one out here in the bottom of the first. Looking to first, and the throw back safely. Had two runners in scoring position with no outs. Now you got a runner at first with one out and only one run in, so they were able to erase one of the runners in scoring position. And now the pitch and a fly ball to right, and it's going to fall and get past the right fielder, and this is going to go for extra bases, and they're going to wave Carter Hanbury around, and the throw, there's not going to be a throw, and it's a triple for Dylan DeSherry, and it's 2-0 Dutchtown with the lead.
Yeah, good job by DeSherry right there. I mean, two strikes, you're just kind of trying to battle, put something in play. That one off the end of the bat, maybe kind of fooled Romero out there. It looks like he thought it was hitting maybe a little bit harder, and had to kind of rush in there at the end and didn't quite get to it, get by him.
Right,
Hanbury finished the score.
So Romero could not make the play and got past him, and it turns into a triple. And now Dylan Champagne, the Dutchtown catcher, at the plate and takes ball one. So now 2-0 Griffins in the bottom of the first. And there's a ball outside. See the runner at third in the box on the bottom right. 2-0 pitch. Infield in, way outside. And it's 3-0. So Dutchtown putting the ball in play out there. And they're going to have a little conference on the mound. But they've been able to put the ball in play. Nothing really solidly hit. Nothing screaming out there, but they're finding the holes and they're getting the runs.
Yeah, you got to think, you know, maybe Hayden might be getting a little frustrated here. He's made some really good pitches.
Yeah.
And, you know, he had a couple, you know, ahead of a couple hitters, and they just get a little piece of it and ends up in Dutchtown's favor. It gets a little frustrating sometimes. You just got to keep chugging, keep making your pitches. You know, you'll start getting those outs.
And it's 3-1 after the strike. 3-1 pitch, and that's a walk. Second walk of the first inning. So now we have runners at first and third. Champagne at first, DeSherry at third, and this will bring up the designated hitter, Andrew Fields, and we're going to get a courtesy runner checking in, but first there's going to be a conference on the mound as Hanville's coach is going to have a talk with his infield.
Yeah, probably not a bad thing. You know, once you fall behind to Champagne, you got a runner on third base, less than two outs.
Number 28,
you know, righty facing the lefty. You don't want to kind of give in. You already have your infield in trying to cut that run down at home plate. But once you fall behind, you really don't want to give him anything that he can elevate, get to the outfield, and pick up that easy RBI. So, I mean, you end up pitching around him. Yeah, it looks like a walk. He's got a first base. But now you're in position to get that one-pitch double play and get yourself, you know, off the field without giving up a run.
That's exactly what they need right here. The courtesy runner coming in for Champagne is going to be number 28, Ryland Mayo. Mayo, a familiar last name here in the Dutchtown baseball community. As Logan is the number 9 hitter in the lineup today.
I feel like we've had Mayo's going through here for the last 15 years.
Many years. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, the older brother played 3 years ago as well on that team that made it all the way to the semis, and there's a strike.
Yeah, see, to me, that's a great pitch right there by Hyden. If you can, I mean, he's been throwing the ball, you know, on the outside part of the plate, but Dutchtown's just been getting enough of them to cause a little havoc, I guess. But that pitch right there, fastball inside, if you can pitch in there, you can last a long time.
And Mayu's going, and it's hitting the hole to left field, and a runner will score. And so DeSherry crosses the plate, and it's 3-0 Dutchtown with runners
on first and second after the RBI single by Andrew Fields.
Yeah, good job by Fields right there. Got a little hanging breaking ball. You just saw a fastball in. So he's protecting inside. That breaking ball stays, you know, it starts on the inside at the same spot. Doesn't really break like the other ones have been breaking, kind of hung in there. Fields able to get the barrel on it. I'm sure Hyden wanted that thing maybe a little bit further outside.
And this will bring up Caleb Wall, the right fielder for Dutchtown. 3-0. One out, bottom of the first. Great shot right there of the Dutchtown right fielder. And outside to Wall, so now count goes to 2-0. One out, Mayo at second, courtesy runner. Fields at first. Now 3-0, pitching inside. I think he's getting a little frustrated at this point.
Yeah, and that's what I was going to say. I mean, like, even that last at bat, great pitch to first pitch of the hitter, but then ends up hanging that curveball or that little breaking ball he throws to Fields there. But, I mean, it's the right pitch. It's just a wrong spot, so you can't give up. I mean, you still got to try to execute your locations if you're hiding here.
And there's a strike taking all the way. So count now 3-1. Expecting to get the green light right here. Should see a good pitch. And they call a strike after he tosses bat for ball four.
Yeah. We saw those exact two pitches right there to McCoy, the first at bat of the game that got, you know, that got balled. So.
Right. That was right around that knee area. Didn't get it the first time. Got it right there. Now the count is full. 3-2, one out. And they go look at second. Mayo back safely. As Gregson, the second baseman, playing close to the bag. And there's a soft bouncer to short, the throw to first. Good job by the first baseman, Parker. So Terrio to Parker, 6-3 for the second out. Runners on second and third with two outs.
Yeah, another good pitch right there by Hyden. That's what I'm talking about. Gets that ball just on the inside, just on the hands of Wall there. As you see that shortstop, Terrio, round that ball. That's a really good play. You saw him round it, come get that hop that he wanted. Got it out front. Knew he couldn't turn two. Just goes over to first base for the sure out.
Now we have Ethan Oakland playing third base for the Griffins. Takes ball one. So on the ground out, Fields moves to second. Mayo moves to third. Base hit would blow this game wide open in the bottom of the first. Dutchtown already with a 3-run spot in the bottom of the first as Oakland takes ball two.
Yeah, Griffin's looking for a big one right here. Just, I mean, anything. Doesn't have to be a blast or anything. Just a little shoo-shoo over the infield to score two runs right here.
A little behind that one, maybe.
Yeah, Oakland a little tardy. I mean, Hyden's got a little get up on that fastball. That's when he starts to elevate it.
2-1 count. Close pitch, but ball three. Try to get that low outside corner. Umpire didn't call it. 3-1. First base is open. Number 9 hitter on deck. 3-1 and a swing and a miss.
Yeah, so that's the location I'm talking about right there. Something at the top of the zone, just a tick above the hands of Oakland there. It's tough to get on top of.
3-2 count. Hanville trying to get out of this inning. And fouled away. Good job of staying alive, fighting off the inside pitch. 3-2.
Good job on both sides right there. Good pitch by Hyden. Great job by Oakland to foul that off. You never anticipate that fastball on the inside right there. Protect and try to get one out over the plate.
And 3-2, and that one a little late, but foul towards the Hanville dugout. Looks like everybody's okay.
Oakland shot that one over there with some velocity.
Absolutely. Good thing there's some protection out there. So the count remains 3-2. Pitch number 8. And there's a bouncer to short. And good grab by Terrio over to Parker for the third out. And that's going to do it. But Dutchtown scores three runs, three hits, no errors, two left. And 3-0 Dutchtown after the first. We'll take a break. You're watching the Rev Game of the Week.
Your business is as unique as Southeast Louisiana. People, culture, family. We know what it means to be local. Rev is the only communications provider with support teams that live and work in the same Louisiana communities that we serve. Customer-first localism is truly in our DNA. Our promise is to bring your business the reliability and local support you deserve. We've been connecting communities in Louisiana for 85 years, and we're ready to serve you and your business. Rev Business.
The athletic training staff of Dutchtown High School would like to thank Advantage Physical Therapy, SCC Heating and Cooling, Tata Law Firm, Raising Cane's in Prairieville, Ross Downing Buick GMC, Hollis Orthodontics, Baton Rouge Orthopedic Clinic Foundation, Peak Performance Physical Therapy, for their support of our Griffins Sports Medicine Program.
Three runs for Dutchtown in the bottom of the first. They lead Hanville 3-0, and a 1-2-3 inning in the top of the first for Oberle and the Griffins. And now we'll see 4, 5, and 6. That's going to be Gregson, Morales.
Beating off the top of the second inning for
Sorry
Hanville.
About that, and Parker.
Second baseman number 2, Ryan Gregson.
Super efficient for Oberle in the first inning there. I mean, what do you think? 10 pitches at the most. Which is, I mean, that's kind of your goal as a pitcher. If you can get out with 10 pitches per inning,
right,
you're going to be out there for a long time, right?
So Ryan Gregson at the plate. And first pitch, fly ball, sky high to right field. Wall is there, makes a catch. So back-to-back innings, the first pitch is a first pitch out. Got a bouncer to second to start the first inning.
Now
got the fly ball to right
to
start the second inning. And so now Chase Morales comes to the plate with one out in the top of the second.
Yeah, and if you're Oberle, I mean, if you see him being aggressive trying to swing at that first pitch, throw a strike anywhere on that plate, just something down in the zone. Try to get a little ground out early in the count.
First pitch, filling the strike zone, and it's strike one. To Morales, center fielder, and so breaking ball just outside. So 1-1. So far, the best start that Coach Shake could envision. Three runs in the first, and four quick outs for Oberle. But there's ball two. 2-1. One out here in the top of the second. Jeff Borsch, Mike Moeller with you. Dutchtown High School, Griffin Field. And 3-1 the count.
Yeah, good job right there by Oberle. Take a deep breath, take a little lap around the mound there. Just trying to overcook those last three pitches, trying to put a little bit too much extra on them. It's always going to leave you up in the zone.
And that's sky high towards second. Looks like the first baseman, DeSherry, is going to make the call, and he makes the catch. So got out of a 3-1 hole with the high fly ball to first base.
Yeah, and I love that. I mean, like, he took his time, right, took a breath, calmed himself
Parker.
Down. The three pitches prior were all elevated, made a good pitch down the zone, which changes the eye level of Morales. So, it's tough to barrel anything after that.
Now we get Bo Parker, first baseman for the Tigers, left-handed hitter, takes a ball. Two outs, and that's fouled to the screen. Comes back to Champagne. And count even, 1-1. Ball two. One pitch from Overly, and that's lost outside. And gets behind 3-1 again. So back-to-back hitters get a 3-1 count. Trying to get out this inning. Has retired the first five batters in a row. Steps away for a second. Now he's ready. And that's inside, ball four. So the first base runner of the night, and with two outs,
now
that's going to bring up
number 24, Romero.
So Cole Romero, the right fielder, two outs and fouled away.
Overly's no problem getting ahead of these hitters, right? I think he's throwing the first pitch fastball strike, or first pitch for a strike to every single one of these hitters. The only one that he lost is Parker on that last one. You just got to be really careful. I know you're up 3-0, but those two-out walks usually come back to haunt you.
And fouled away again off the screen. And it's 0-2. Again, Parker at first base runner of the night for Hahnville. Left-handed hitter, Romero at the plate, behind 0-2. And they were setting up outside all the way and hit his mark, but it was way outside.
Not bad 0-2 pitch right there. Let's see if he tries to drop a curveball on his back foot right here, or maybe even a fastball on the inside half.
1-2. Thought about chasing it for a second. A little high. Count even, 2-2, two outs. Top of the second. Runner at first. 3-0 Griffins. And swung at one at his chin, and it's a fly ball to third, and it's caught by Ethan Oakland. A little adventure right there, but he makes the catch, and so three fly outs, pop-ups right there, I guess you could say.
As
it's going to be no runs on, no hits, no errors, and one left on base. We go to the bottom of the second, and it's 3-0 Dutchtown leads Hahnville. And here in the middle of the second, we will take a look at what Dutchtown has done on the season. And we talked about that earlier in the pregame. The one that stands out is Hewitt Trustville out of Alabama, the 5-3 victory. Hewitt Trustville actually lost a couple of games this weekend to Santa Maria and Dutchtown, but some good private school victories on the season so far for Dutchtown.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure Trustville lost to East Ascension as well. I'm not sure if they played four games this weekend, but I know they got three losses all through the Ascension Parish schools. So good job by Ascension Parish all the way around there. But, yeah, I mean, like I said earlier, four games in 3 days, typically if you split, if you come out of that 2-2, I mean, that's not bad, right? 3-1 is like a victory. And for Dutchtown to come out of those four games 4-0 on top of that win at U High to start this season all 5-0, I mean, Coach Shake's got to really be excited about that.
And so a good start and a good start to tonight's game with three runs in the bottom of the first. And we're going to see 9-1-2 who are going to face Hyden. That's going to be Logan Mayu, Casey McCoy, and Kobe Mitchell. And Jacob Hyden, Mike, you liked what he was trying to do. Just had some bad luck in the first inning.
Yeah, I love the stuff. I mean, he's being aggressive. He's trying to attack the strike zone. Made some really good pitches and then, had a little bit of bad luck. And then, maybe missed a couple locations that he.
He missed that location. That's for sure.
Yeah. Typically not what you want to do with number 9 hole hitter, right? So
right.
Immediately.
Now
batting
for the Griffin shortstop, number 7.
He's just trying to go inside a little bit.
Looks like it hit his left arm as he kind of turned out the way, and he's going to be on base at first. And now you have top of the lineup with Casey McCoy, who came all the way back from a two-strike count and drew a walk in the top of the first. That's where you like to start off with the breaking balls to McCoy in the first inning. Got the 0-2 start, but then gave up the walk. And that kind of started the problems in the bottom of the first for Hanville.
Yeah. You see Hyden really quick on that pitch right there. Not sure if he was kind of protecting against a steal right there or not, or if he's a little frustrated. But I'm sure Coach Vial has a pretty close eye on him as we see a little action in their bullpen right now.
Yeah, and the Mayos are fast. We know that already. And there's a strike. Count 1-1. Mayo taking a good lead at first, and foul ball out of play toward the right side. And now ahead in the count 1-2 to McCoy. No outs in the bottom of the second inning. And he's going and in the dirt, and the throw from his knees or from the squat, and it not in time, and a stolen base. Yeah, Mayu.
Good jump right there by Mayu. And you see Moyer didn't have much of a chance. Pretty tough pitch to throw on. Just picked it and stayed in his squatting position. Tried to make a throw down there. Got it down there pretty quick, but not quite quick enough to get Mayu.
So now runner in scoring position with no outs. 2-2 is the count. And that's outside, 3-2. McCoy walked his first at bat, as we told you. Trying to draw his second walk of the day. And ball 4. So McCoy does not have an official at bat yet, as he's drawn 2 walks.
Yeah, pretty patient. You love to see that from the leadoff hitter. I mean, first at bat goes down 0-2, fights back and draws a walk, and then that at bat right there. Hyde not really close to the plate on that one.
And so he's going to be removed. And we're going to go to the bullpen. And so we'll take a short break while the new pitcher gets warmed up. You're watching the Rev Game of the Week.
As a local provider, we understand the unique challenges and rewards as a Southeast Louisiana business. And we're right here with you, powering your business with local know-how and the unmatched service you deserve. Our internet and managed services are more than connectivity. They're our promise to provide the most important thing every business needs, consistency and quality. We're here to help. For a limited time, get 3 months free. Rev Business. Visit us at letsrev.biz.
The athletic training staff of Dutchtown High School would like to thank Advantage Physical Therapy, FCC Heating and Cooling, Tata Law Firm, Raising Cane's in Prairieville, Ross Downing Buick GMC, Hollis Orthodontics, Baton Rouge Orthopedic Clinic Foundation, Peak Performance Physical Therapy, for their support of our Griffins Sports Medicine Program.
We're back, and it's 3-0 Dutchtown, and we've already had a pitching change with no outs in the top of the second, and now you have some information on him.
We're assuming he'll probably stay in and hit for himself. Maybe it's I think Hyden was going to hit for himself the leadoff next inning anyway, but kind of inherits a mess here. Runners on first and second, no outs. Called to come on and try to put this fire out.
And he's going to face Mitchell, the number two hitter, who had a base hit his first at bat. And he's offering a bunt, pulls away and takes a ball. And maybe a wise decision to try to move the runners over with no outs and a 3-0 lead. The corners are in, maybe expecting it. And he does drop it, and it's a nice one, and it dies in the throw to first. Good job picking that up, 3-4.
Perfect bunt right there by Mitchell. That's exactly what you want to do. You want to make that first baseman come in and field that ball. Or typically, actually, you want that third baseman to come in, but it was,
now back
it was dead enough.
Left fielder number 22,
and you're not going to get a play at third base there. You see Bo Parker make a good play. No panic right there. Comes in and makes that throw to Gregson for his first out.
And this is what you want, the number three hitter with two runners in scoring position. At the plate, Carter Hanberry. He takes the ball outside. Carter Hanberry is going to be playing college ball next season, but that's going to be football at Southeast. Infield's in. Can't afford to give up any more runs. Swing and a miss. Good fastball right there.
Good cut right there, too. Kind of came unglued.
Yep. Hanberry's been a consistent contributor since his sophomore season. He was a DH sophomore year. He played right field last season's left field this year. He had an injury last season, played through that, and now he's back at full strength. We're going to see what he's going to do, but he takes a strike right there, and it's 1-2.
Yeah, good pitch right there by Teague. Pull the string, about 10 miles an hour difference from that fastball that he just blew by Hanberry.
Oh, and he swung it one outside. Maybe out of the strike zone, and it's a strikeout for the new Conville pitcher, and he gets two quick outs with runners in second and third, and he'll face Dylan DeSherry, who also got a base hit his first at bat.
Notice the location of that last pitch by 2-2. I mean, he spun that breaking ball the pitch before, pulled the string, you know, had Hanberry way out front, then sped him up with that fastball on the outside part of the plate.
And a little check swing. Foul ball. DeSherry had a fly ball to right that died before Romero could get to it, and it turned into a triple. And it scored McCoy.
Yeah, we talked about that wind. I mean, that ball was into the tee for the wind. I'm sure that wind knocked it down.
Woo. And there's a strike. Yeah, the wind killed it. The wind's blowing out to left. He's going against the wind out to right field.
I'll tell you what, that breaking ball right there had some teeth.
Absolutely. It was beautiful.
That thing changed lanes. Had DeSherry all locked up.
0-2. Tries outside. Not offering. 1-2. Two outs. Two runners in scoring position. And the breaking ball doesn't quite break enough. 2-2.
Good take by DeSherry right there. That's exactly what Teague was trying to set him up for. I mean, right pitch, just wrong location, right? We mentioned that before with Hyden up there. He still maybe try to get a chase there, but DeSherry lays off.
And a swing and a miss, a foul tip, actually, for the strikeout. And so no runs after getting two leadoff batters on base. No runs, no hits, no errors. Two left on base. And
bottom
after
two,
it's 3-0.
No runs,
Dutchtown
no hits, no
will take a break.
All.
You're watching the Rev, game of the week.
Your score, Dutchtown 3, Palmville 0.
Your business is as unique as Southeast Louisiana. People, culture, family. We know what it means to be local. REV is the only communications provider with support teams that live and work in the same Louisiana communities that we serve. Customer-first localism is truly in our DNA. Our promise is to bring your business the reliability and local support you deserve. We've been connecting communities in Louisiana for 85 years, and we're ready to serve you and your business. REV Business.
The athletic training staff of Dutchtown High School would like to thank Advantage Physical Therapy, SCC Heating and Cooling, Tata Law Firm, Raising Cane's in Prairieville, Ross Downing Buick GMC, Hollis Orthodontics, Baton Rouge Orthopedic Clinic Foundation, Peak Performance Physical Therapy, for their support of our Griffins Sports Medicine Program.
Welcome back to the Rev Game of the Week. Jeff Porsche, Mike Moeller with you. It's 3-0 Dutchtown with the lead. And going to the top of the third, Oberle doing a good job so far for the Griffins. He's going to face Teague, Jeffrey, and
leading off the inning for the Tigers, pitcher number 19.
Moyer. That's 8-9-1. So Teague is going to bat for Hayden. Hayden was the pitcher who started, but he was going to hit for himself. And speaking of hitting, he just got hit right there. And so both leadoff hitters in the bottom of the second and the top of the third reach base after being hit by the pitcher.
Yeah, a couple pitches inside on both of them.
Now
right there, just got away.
Number three, Jacob
see
Jeffrey.
Overly kind of spin out on that when you see his finish was right over there to the first base side. Nothing intentional, I'm sure.
Absolutely not. So now Jeffrey will come to the plate.
Now running at first base, number 13, Bennett Knockin.
So courtesy runner Knockin at first for Hahnville. Jeffrey, the third baseman for the Tigers at the plate. And the ball outside. So far, solid outing for Oberle in the first two innings. Faced seven batters, gave up a walk, but he hit the first batter here in the top of the third. Knockin running at first. There's ball two. So not finding the strike zone yet here in the top of the third.
Yeah, I mean, you kind of expect that. I mean, it's still early in the season. Might have had a couple outings by, you know, each pitch or whatever, but they're still trying to settle in, find their groove.
There's a strike on that outside corner, 2-1. Here in the top of the third. Number nine hitter at the plate. Yeah, foul tip. Champagne, 2-2. So now all of a sudden he's fighting at strike zone and is ahead of the number nine hitter. And count now 2-2. The Knockin at first has a good lead. Running for the pitcher Teague, who was hit. And he was hit.
Did he make a swing?
They may be calling a foul tip. They may have gone off the bat.
Yep. Foul ball right there. Probably got a little pinch on the bottom of his hand there.
Oh, that's a tough
between
break.
There in the knob.
Let's see how that looks. It took a quick change of trajectory, that's directly off the knob. Yep. It looks like it, that's for sure. Now, third base coach over on the Hahnville side pleading his case, saying that did not hit the bat. I think the umpire had the better angle there.
Yeah. You see Jeffrey, too, not making much of a fuss about it. I mean, he knows.
So the count remains 2-2. Dodged the bullet right there. Strike three called on that outside corner, and
One out strikeout for Jordan Oberle. That's his second strikeout of the day.
Big pitch right there, almost not fair after you just throw one right off his hands, literally on the
now
inside
corner. Yeah.
Paint that outside corner. It's just tough to cover the whole plate like that.
You're the number nine hitter, and you just got jammed up like that. You're probably not going to want to offer right there. And now Moyer, the leadoff hitter for Hahnville. And he takes the first pitch, and it's a pop-up to short. And easy play for McCoy. And so Moyer, the leadoff hitter, he's seen two pitches. He swung at both of them, made two outs. And that's the second out of the third inning.
Sometimes you see that. I mean, that can be some hitters' M.O., right? They like to hit the first pitch, be aggressive or whatever. Typically not in the leadoff position do you see that.
You're right. You usually see him taking some pitches, but he's not doing that. And Garisco is now at the plate, and they're going to go back and take a look at Knockhand at first. He's got a decent lead. You might expect that from a courtesy runner. Garisco flew out to right field. Made solid contact, but it was right to the right fielder wall. And he's going, and there's a throw, and it's in time. 2-6 for the putout. Great throw right there by Dylan Champagne.
Well, pitch up and out of the zone. You see Champagne just bounce out of that squad. Make a good exchange and a perfect throw down to second base before it flies a tag.
What you might want to see from a future Dutchtown quarterback. Maybe starting next season. Never know. But no runs, no hits, no errors, and nobody left. And it's 3-0 Dutchtown after 2.5, and we're going to keep it here and talk about Dutchtown's upcoming tournament schedule. As they have, we're not in district season yet, so that means a lot of weekend tournaments taking place in the area and outside the area as well.
You see right there. Talked about Steve Richardson tournament last week, where the Central Parish teams all went 11-0. It's never happened before, right? So next weekend they're going to travel to St. Tammany. They're going to play in that tournament for a couple, 2-3 days. That'll be another four games. The following weekend they'll be back here in Ascension Parish for the Jay Patterson tournament for another 3 or 4 days. And then the Tuke Gagne tournament will follow that as well. So, I mean, four tournaments in four straight weekends. You better have some pitching.
Absolutely. That's where we're going to see if Dutchtown has some pitchers to back up Jordan Oberle. We knew Jordan Oberle was going to be a solid contributor and one of the big starters for Dutchtown. He's doing a great job tonight, but it's a young season, and Coach Shea has some ideas on who he would like to see, but need to see him in action before you make any decisions like that.
You kind of get a little experience, right? I mean, like, once you get deeper into the playoffs, you have two or three rounds where you have best two out of three.
Yes.
A couple of those, I mean, if you go 2-3 games, you want to have your pitching depth with some experience already by the time you get there.
And it's going to be Dylan Champagne, Andrew Fields, Caleb Wall for the Griffins. So Champagne.
Say it all the time. You make a good defensive play when you come off the field. You lead off the next.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
Oh, sorry.
No. Great minds think alike. Not complaining about that. 1-0, and there's a strike on the outside corner. So Champagne, he reached on a base hit. Oh, actually, he reached on a walk, excuse me. And Landon Teague on the mound. And there's an inside-out swing, and it's going to drop for a base hit, and he's going to stay at first. A little inside-out opposite field in no man's land for the single.
Now batting for the Griffins.
Yeah, that's exactly what we want to do. Great pitch by Teague, right? Oh, down
yep.
And out. Great spot right there. Exactly where you want to throw it. Sometimes you just have to tip your cap. I mean, see Champagne just get, I don't even want to say got the barrel on it right there. Kind of just filleted that thing in the right spot out there in left field for a leadoff single.
So perfect job by him, and he's got the single and the walk on the day. And Mayo is going to run at first base. Andrew Fields at the plate. He has a base hit and an RBI. And there's the ball way high.
Right
the 1-0 pitch low, 2-0. So Dutchtown doing a good job getting on base. Even when they're not making solid contact, they're finding the holes. And they lead 3-0.
Yeah, and that's the old adage. I mean, just, you know, make some contact, put the ball in play, put the pressure on the defense, and get things happening, right? Don't always have to hit it square.
And the runner going, and Fields protecting him, bounces it foul.
Yeah, a little hit and run right there. 2-0. Fields got to break the ball up on the zone. Those are the ones that are maybe a little bit tough to handle, try to hit that ball on the ground. You know, you're taught to hit, you know, a line drive or something on the ground whenever you got the hit and run on.
Andrew Fields, one of the new starters here for the Griffins. And we talked about the football team. He's a wide receiver on the football team, and he made some big touchdown catches in the playoffs. His brother plays tackle at Ole Miss. So a good sporting family, the Fields here at Dutchtown. And that gets away from the catcher, and Mayo's going to get second base easily. 3-1 count now. So they're worried about Mayo going. He went on the foul ball earlier, and he gets second base the easy way.
Yeah, so if you're Fields now, you want to try to hit that ball somewhere on the right side so Mayo can just advance to third base with less than 2 outs.
And there was a huge hole out there as the second baseman is protecting the bag and Mayo. And count now full. But he has about 70 feet of room right there. And he takes ball four.
Okay. Not bad. I was about to say that's a perfect pitch to shoot through that right side right there.
Exactly.
Get that runner over, but I mean,
now batting for the right fielder number 13, Caleb Wall.
Caleb Wall now at the plate. And again, this is what you had last inning. Runners at first and second, nobody out. Dutchtown didn't get any runs in the second inning, though. This may be a situation where Wall may be trying to move the runners over. Corners are in. Nobody out. And he squares. And they're going to take that as a ball. They're not going to say that he offered that one. And I think that the coach might be asking, did he offer right there?
Yeah, maybe try to get some help.
It looked like he may have reached briefly for a second, but the second base umpire is going to say, no, he did not. It was a feeble attempt if it was one. I'll just say that. So ball one. And that time he was not going to offer, but he takes a strike anyway. 1-1. In the second, Mitchell had a perfect sacrifice bunt down the first baseline. We'll see if Wall can do the same. And it gets away from the catcher again, and now he doesn't need to bunt. The runners have moved over. So now 2-1.
Good take right there by Wall. Got his job done. Didn't have to do anything.
The catcher's losing the handle right there.
Yeah, Moyer. I mean, you typically don't expect that ball. You know, you're trying to give him the bunt as a pitcher. You know, they're giving you an out. Throw a strike so they can put the ball in play. So Moyer probably not expecting that ball to be that up out of his zone.
And a strike on that outside corner. So now a count 2-2. Still nobody out. Second and third. And
looks like it hit him.
Yeah, I thought right I was waiting to see. I think he might have thought it may have hit his shirt, but I didn't see it.
That's a pretty good pitch, too.
Absolutely.
It was called a strike.
It was close. I thought so, too. That's what I was waiting for. I was waiting for something. And there's a bouncer foul. Good pickup by Jeffrey, but count will remain 3-2. 1-3-5. Base hit. We'll blow it open again. Infield in. Everybody in. Oh, and there's a strike and a swing and a miss. Nice pitch by Teague, and it's one out.
Yeah, big out right there for Teague. Huge out. Even if the base opens, you want to,
now batting,
you want to try to be careful because you can load the bases if you get a double play set up all around the diamond. He's just rare back to beat that ball right by wall for that number one.
Now Oakland. Oakland takes a ball. He made the third out of the first inning. 0-1. And he takes a strike. Nice breaking ball.
Good pitch right there.
Oakland, the starting quarterback for the Dutchtown Griffins, a team that went to the state semifinals. And there's a strike, breaking ball.
Leveled off on the breaking ball. Doesn't look that, like that's what O'Quinn wants to pull the trigger on.
Oh, and he offered that one right there, and that's a strikeout. I think he kind of knew he made a mistake, and that's a tough break in the second out of the inning.
Yeah, he did. He got caught in between right there. Good job by Teague. I mean, he flips two in there for strikes. Looks like, you know, O'Quinn was looking fastball with both hands there. Go back to the well. Try to throw it the third time. However, location, 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 just off the plate away, and you get a little half kind of a swing attempt from Oakland for strike three.
So now Logan Mayo. Ball outside. Onville trying to get out of a second and third no out hole for the second inning in a row. And that's fly ball. It's in play, but doesn't look like it. The first baseman could get to it.
Yeah, drop. He got underneath it, kind of, you know, looking back over your shoulder. Those are the tough ones.
Right.
Looks like he's a little dark out there, too, man. It's just maybe, I don't know. Might be where we are.
Bo Parker made a great effort. So Mayo, if Mayo can get a base hit, Mayo will score. And there you see the replay. And, oh, he got the heel of his glove.
Yeah. Those are tough. I mean, you're not used to running like that. Probably on your heels, balls bouncing around. Just tough to kind of locate that ball.
Breaking ball. He's got trying to make them offer at that outside pitch. Mayo did a better job than Oakland.
But here's the thing. Like on Oakland, he threw two for a strike, so he established. You know, now Oakland has to protect against that. So now you can throw one out of the zone, right? But if you don't show the hitter you can throw it in the zone, then they're not going to be, you know, they're not going to have a tendency to expand the zone and swing at something just off the plate.
That one was inside, and he just fouled it away. So now it counts 2-2. And one strike away from getting out of the jam. Oh, that's a beauty. Strike three. And three strikeouts in a row. And no runs on a hit. And no errors. Two left on base. After three, it's 3-0 Dutchtown. We'll take a break. You're watching the Rev Game of the Week.
As a local provider, we understand the unique challenges and rewards as a Southeast Louisiana business. And we're right here with you, powering your business with local know-how and the unmatched service you deserve. Our internet and managed services are more than connectivity. They're our promise to provide the most important thing every business needs, consistency and quality. We're here to help. For a limited time, get 3 months free. Rev Business. Visit us at letsrev.biz.
The athletic training staff of Dutchtown High School would like to thank Advantage Physical Therapy, SCC Heating and Cooling, Tata Law Firm, Raising Cane's in Prairieville, Ross Downing Buick GMC, Hollis Orthodontics, Baton Rouge Orthopedic Clinic Foundation, Peak Performance Physical Therapy, for their support of our Griffins Sports Medicine Program.
Welcome back to the Rev Game of the Week. We were talking about how the wind was blowing out. Really, nobody's taking advantage of it tonight, as you haven't had any really hard hit balls, but if anything gets into that left center field area, it's going to go far. Right now, Dutchtown leads 3-0.
Yeah, the only ball we've seen it affect so far was that fly ball to right field.
In the first inning,
that just absolutely died, just kind of ran into a wall and gave Morales,
Romero.
Gave Romero some fits out there.
Now you see Garisco. And a strike. It's Garisco, Terrio, and Gregson. That's 2-3-4 for Hahnville here in the fourth.
Garisco was at the dish when Champagne cut down the runner at second for the third out of the inning.
Right, that was a beautiful throw. 0-2. Oh, he's saying it hit him.
And yeah, you could hear it.
It did. That's a tough break on an 0-2 pitch. He had a pitch to waste, but he didn't want to waste it like that.
Shortstop, number 14, Talon.
Looked like he maybe polished the front of his shoe right there.
Yeah. Might have caught the inside of that shin, a little shin burger.
So Talon Terrio is going to come to the plate. This is the third base runner that Oberle has given up today. Parker got on base on a walk, but he was stranded. And then Teague got hit by a pitch, and then the courtesy runner was erased on the steal attempt. And now you have Garisco at first, and Terrio takes ball one. And that's check swing, foul ball.
Oh, excuse me right there by Terrio.
So Hahnville, they're in their Ascension Parish portion of their schedule. Tomorrow they're going to be playing East Ascension.
Yeah,
but they don't have lights.
It's going to be during the day, yeah,
right.
They don't have lights.
Wanted that one, didn't get it. Count 2-1. Garisco still at first, taking a good lead. Terrio, the shortstop today. And there's a shot base hit to left field, and Hahnville has some early business here in the top of the third. Runners at first and second, nobody out.
Yeah, great job right there by Terrio. I mean, that's a breaking ball, 2-1. Great pitch by Oberle. I mean, it's exactly where you want him.
Now
that breaking ball,
second
he's looking breaking
two.
Ball 2-1, right?
Ryan especially Gregson.
Down in the zone. Well, apparently Terrio was. Got the head of the bat on the ball. Nice line drive single over the shortstop's head.
Now you have Ryan Gregson. He flew out to right field. And they're going to try to move the runners over, but it's foul. It's 3-0 right now. You get two runners in scoring position and start chipping away at this Dutchtown lead. It's still early in this ballgame. Dutchtown has had a couple of opportunities to get a 4, maybe a 5 spot, but they have not been able to do that.
Yeah, Harmville trying to scratch some runs any way they can. Typically, you don't see the four hole, the cleanup hitter trying to lay down sacrifice bunts with no outs.
Let's see what he's doing right here. And he drops it, and it's a good one to third, and he's going to beat that out.
Yeah, safe all day. Great, great punt right there.
Absolutely.
You heard Coach Vial or somebody yell at him after the first burn attempt, hey, barrel above the hands, barrel above the hands. He made his correction right there, laid down a beauty for an actual base hit.
No doubt about it.
Now batting,
and now the bases are loaded with no outs. And the center fielder, Chase Morales, who popped up a mile high to first base in the second inning. Infield playing normal depth. Ball outside. So you have Garisco at third, Terrio at second, Gregson at first, nobody out. Tying run is at first base. Ball low.
If you're overly here, right, you can't try to overdo it. Don't try to, you know, get all three outs by yourself, try to punch everybody out. Your job right now, you're up 3-0. Get an out right here. Get out, out, out. If you give up a run or two, you're still in the lead, right?
Yep.
What you can't have happen is let this thing get out of control and snowball, and then you give up a crooked number.
Oh, it's a late strike call right there. I was about to say ball three.
That ball's off the plate.
Yeah, and he hadn't been calling that.
No, not at all.
Not for Oberly.
Yeah.
But he got it right there. The umpire to think about that one for a second. And a throw to second. McCoy keeping that ball on him till he gets up.
Yeah, he actually tried that whenever Gregson bunted on that base hit. You saw McCoy trying to put a pickoff play on. He was actually at second base, so probably a good thing Gregson didn't swing away right there because that hole was massive.
Yep. And 3-1, a little high. He has nowhere to put Morales. A run would score on a walk. Right now, Dutchtown leads 3-0. But that may be about to change. And that's a hot shot, but foul down the third baseline toward the Dutchtown dugout. And now you got a full count. Got to be expecting a strike right here, somewhere near the strike zone, I would think. Again, nowhere to put him. 3-2, swing and a miss. Big strikeout for Oberly as Morales goes down swinging.
Yeah, huge pitch. And again, I mean, notice where that location, that ball's down and away, just tucking out on me. You don't have
Parker
to throw it 100 miles an hour down the middle. Make a pitch with the intent, let me get an out, and you'll get a lot more swings and misses right there. But if you're Oberly here, you can't exhale yet. You can't let your guard down. You got to keep your focus, concentration, and keep executing your pitches.
And there's a strike. Now he's found the strike zone. Middle infield playing at double play depth. A double play would get you out of the inning. And that one's a little high and outside. Count 1-1. Bases loaded. 3-0 Dutchtown. Conville threatening. Breaking ball did not break. 2-1. Again, you have Garisco at third, Terrio at second, Gregson at first. And there's a shot to first and a good pickup by Dylan DeSherry. Third unassisted, a run will score. But you got a second out right there.
Yeah, good job by Parker right there. Great pitch, actually, by Overly. You see the catcher, Champagne, set up inside.
Two-run right there.
Overly makes his pitch, but, you know, I mean, to lefties, that's that happy zone. That's an easy pitch for them to get to, drop the head on the ball. Hit it fairly hard. DeSherry makes a good pickup. Doesn't try to do too much. Gets the sure out, and they only give up one run now.
And so that was Parker who grounds out the first, and now Romero at the plate. So Bo Parker grounds the first unassisted, run scores. That's Garisco. And now Romero at the plate, 0-1, two outs. But tying run is at second. And there's a swing and a miss. If Dutchtown can get out of this with one run, that's a good break for them.
Yeah, I mean, this is the first laborious inning we've seen Overly have. He's battling through it. I mean, like I said, you don't want to give up a crooked number. If you're Romero right here, you can tie the game with one swing. Pretty good hack right there.
Right, and he's a big guy. He's not thin, we'll say that. And he's not short. He's not small.
He doesn't have to do much here. I mean, just you know, we've seen Dutchtown get a couple little off the enders hits. Same thing right here, tie this game.
Maybe the one break is that he's a left-handed hitter, so he can't really take advantage of that power alley with the wind.
Yeah, if he can hit a homer against the teeth of this wind right now, like, you just have to tip your cap.
Right. Oh, 2. Oh, and did that hit the bat or the hand? I think he's saying the wrist. So look at my glove.
Yeah, he went to swing and it hit his hand, but did he really swing? Let's see.
And
he swung, so
it's going to be a foul ball. That's the second time we've seen that.
Yeah, that little kind of last minute emergency hack right there.
So I think Romero, that one was less obvious than the other one that we saw earlier that definitely hit the bat.
Yeah, the knob of the bat.
Right.
You see the trajectory off of it.
Right. And Romero tried to show maybe a mark or a scuff on his batting glove, but the umpire was not buying what he was selling. And there's a bouncer. And DeSherry's going to make another unassisted play, very close, but a third out. So Hondville scores, but they only get one
run.
And they get one, two base hits. And so after three and a half, our score is Dutchtown 3, Hondville 1. And we're going to keep it here, and we're going to talk about District 5A. And I know you're going to enjoy looking at at least one of the teams at the top of the standings, Mike.
No, I mean, look, I mean, we knew last year when this district began that it was going to be really stout. I mean, you got Dennis Green, Dutchtown, Santa Maria, East Ascension, all undefeated. All three teams in the Central Parish undefeated right now. We know how good Live Oak is. They're actually in last place with a 2-3 record. Walker comes in at 3-2. But, I mean, we're going to see that thing kind of flip-flop throughout the season. But, you know, the thing that stands out to me is East Ascension 4-0. I think they won four games last year.
Yeah.
So, I mean, they've already tied their win total from a year ago. So kudos to them and Coach Jake Cowan. And, you know, what they're doing over there. Santa Maria, we've seen them. We know they're gonna win their games. And,
yeah,
I mean, everybody's going to be tough. The two teams at the bottom now, Walker and Live Oak, I mean, we've seen them 2-3 years ago come in here and kind of wreak some havoc against the Ascension Parish teams. So it'll be interesting.
And we should point out, because, you know, you don't see that very often, but it's only a week into the season, but if you look at the power rankings right now, who's number one in the power rankings. East Ascension is the number one team in the state right now in the power rankings. Now, Dutchtown is, I believe, at 4, and Santa Monica's at about 6. Okay. So Ascension Parish is well represented in the power rankings early in the season. A great start for all three schools. Now you have 1, 2, 3, top of the lineup, McCoy, Mitchell, Hanberry for Dutchtown. And there's a first pitch. And will it stay in play? Yes, it does.
Nice play by Bo Parker over there at first base.
So pop foul out to the third baseman.
First now baseman. Batting for Dutchtown.
Look at that, right there.
First baseman over there, Jeff.
First baseman. Did I say?
I mean, but that ball was over the dugout, almost over the bullpen when it was at its highest point. Came back. Bo Parker never gave up on him. Made a good play right there.
Right. I was marking a 3 on my score sheet, and I said third baseman. I guess let's not do that very often again. Kobe Mitchell now at the plate. He's got a base hit on the day.
And a perfect sack bunt is second at bat.
Yep. And there's a high bouncer. Could be a tough play. The slide and out 4-3. Gregson to Parker for the second out. Now all of a sudden, Hondrell's got 2 quick outs.
Yeah, tough play right there. Gregson knows he can't come and get that in between hop. Knows he got to, he's got to wait on that big hop and has to get rid of it really quick and make an accurate throw, and he did just that. But let's not kind of overlook the job that Landon Teague has done since he's come in. I
mean, absolutely.
You know, we see Dutchtown kind of rush out to that 3-0 lead early in the first inning and haven't pushed any across the plate since he's come in.
And Hanberry takes the ball. He inherited 2 base runners, didn't give up any runs. He put 2 base runners on in the third, didn't give up any runs. And now he's trying to get a 1-2-3 inning. That'll be the first of the night for Hondville. Dutchtown holding on to a 3-1 lead.
Yeah, I mean, he's trying to get his team right back in that dugout where they started to show a little bit of momentum.
Right.
You know, they had Overly on the ropes there. Overly did a great job of working himself out, of wiggling himself kind of out of that jam, and that's what good pitchers do, right? They limit the damage because you're all going to get in some kind of bind, some kind of jam. The good pitchers find a way to get out of it, not typically unscathed, but with minimal damage.
And you saw the breaking ball strike, and now it's 1-2 to Hanberry. And that's fouled away. Count remains 1-2, 2 outs. Now, Hanberry reached on a fielder's choice in the first, scored the second run of the first inning, struck out in the second, strikes out in the fourth. And a 1-2-3 inning. Great job by Landon Teague. No runs, no hits, no errors. Nobody left. And we go to the fifth inning. And it's 3-1. Dutchtown with the lead. We'll take a break. You're watching the Rev Game of the Week.
Your business is as unique as Southeast Louisiana. People, culture, family. We know what it means to be local. Rev is the only communications provider with support teams that live and work in the same Louisiana communities that we serve. Customer-first localism is truly in our DNA. Our promise is to bring your business the reliability and local support you deserve. We've been connecting communities in Louisiana for 85 years, and we're ready to serve you and your business. Rev Business.
The athletic training staff of Dutchtown High School would like to thank Advantage Physical Therapy, SEC Heating and Cooling, Tata Law Firm, Raising Cane's in Prairieville, Ross Downing Buick GMC, Hollis Orthodontics, Baton Rouge Orthopedic Clinic Foundation, Peak Performance Physical Therapy, for their support of our Griffins Sports Medicine Program.
Welcome back to the Rev Game of the Week. Dutchtown at home versus Hondville. Our score 3-1. You can see it right there. You look at those flags just flying out towards left field. Like we said, if somebody can make some contact, it's going to go a
leading
long
off the
way.
Of the fifth inning,
but Oberly labored a little bit in the third inning, or excuse me, the fourth inning as we go into the fifth, and he's going to face 8-9-1, Landon Teague, Jacob Jeffrey, and Truman Moyer. And first pitch is ball, as it's 1-0. Now Teague was hit by a pitch, and then the courtesy runner for him was thrown out on a steal attempt, and a high pop-up on the infield, and the second baseman Mitchell calls off the Sherry at the last second. Good thing he did, because that ball was headed away from the Sherry, and he makes the first out.
Yeah, another tough one. I mean, it seems like every pop fly has been like a big league pop fly, right?
Yes.
They're taking a lot of time coming down, and you still see those flies out in center field. I mean, those things are still starts towards left.
I believe that's the third pop out on the infield.
Yeah, good job on Mitchell right there. I mean, we could hear him from up here. Called the Sherry off. That's what you want, good communication. Eliminates a lot of problems.
Now Jeffrey fouls it directly behind home plate, and it's 0-1, one out. And another pop-up, and this one's going to go to DeSherry.
Got to love the pitcher trying to get himself in there.
Yeah. It looked like he was going to call it. He's like, nope.
He wanted all of that. I love it. They're athletes, too.
Let's let the big guy get it.
I have to apologize. East Ascension, I said they won four games last year, and they already matched their total. They won five last year, so I don't want to sell them short anyway on any of that.
You're right. There's Moyer with a strike. All of a sudden, this game is sped up.
Picked up the pace. Teague with a very efficient inning, last inning for Harnville, and Overly right back all around the zone this inning after his labor-intensive inning.
Right. This is just 180 from that fourth inning, where he was throwing a lot of balls, had a lot of base runners, gave up a run. Trying to get 1-2-3. And there's a fly to right. Wall getting there, makes the catch, and he gets the 1-2-3 inning. And so three up, three down for the second time this inning. Well, actually the third time this game. And after four and a half, no runs, no hits, no errors, by the way. And it's 3-1. Dutchtown leads Harnville, and here in the middle of the fifth, let's look at what Dutchtown has done
over the last 5 years right there in 23. They're ranked, I guess came in a 12th seed. They made it to the regionals in 22. Came in as a 3 seed, made it all the way to the semifinals, and then ended up with that heartbreaking loss to West Monroe over there in Sulphur in 2021. They came in as a 13 seed. The quarterfinals in 20, we all know that was a COVID year, got shut down March 14th. And in 2019, they made it through the bye districts and came in as a 13 seed. But I mean, like every, I want to say that they've made the playoffs every year that Coach Shake has been there, other than the COVID year 2020, which obviously season was canceled.
That's right. And these last 3 years, Coach Shake has gone back to that Dutchtown winning tradition as quarterfinals and beyond. Yet he did lose to Live Oak in the regionals last year, but like you said, got to Sulphur the year before that, had a good run in 2021, and this season he's off to a good start. And I asked him, how you feel about the season. He said, we're going to get better as the year goes along. I mean, he doesn't know what he's got yet, but he's got a good feeling about it right now.
Sure, and that's all you can ask for. You just want to improve, get better, kind of eliminate or minimize your mistakes.
The bottom of the fifth inning for the Griffins.
Try to hone your skills, pick up some time to hit and get some good outings on the mound, and turn yourself into, a force to be reckoned with towards the end of the season. Try to run into those playoffs on a roll.
So we'll see what they can do as the season goes along. We'll be covering them a lot this spring as Dylan DeSherry gets to the plate and he fouls it away. It's DeSherry, Champagne, and Fields. That's 4, 5, and 6 for Dutchtown as it's fouled away, 0-1. DeSherry made a couple of plays in the top of the inning, and he leads off in the bottom of the inning. There's a breaking ball, misses outside. DeSherry, we talked about Casey McCoy. He's a Raging Cajuns commit. Dylan DeSherry's also a Raging Cajuns commit, but he's going to be playing tight end. As you get two Raging Cajuns, going to be in Lafayette in the near future for Dutchtown. Fouled away, and it's 1-2. DeSherry adjusting the gloves. He got the triple to right field that scored a run and a bouncer foul. He struck out in the second. This is his third at bat. This is his first year at first base.
Pretty good job right there by DeSherry. Got that breaking ball, sat back, maybe a little out front, but kept his hands back just long enough to fight this pitch off to live to see another one.
And he takes the ball. 2-2. Three-one. Dutchtown leads Hahnville here in the bottom of the fifth, and the count goes full. Landon Teague on the mound. He replaced Jacob Hayden, who was pulled in the bottom of the second after giving up two base runners. Foul tip in the glove. Strike three. And another strikeout. That's back-to-back strikeouts for Landon
Teague. Now batting for Dutchtown, catching number four.
And now Dylan Champagne will come to the plate.
Not just a rare back throw me 3-2 fastball right by DeSherry either. I've been preaching pretty much the whole game rotation right there. That ball's on the outside part of the plate down in the zone, just tough to catch up to.
Champagne at the plate. Outside. Ball one. So he walked. Got a base hit. That opposite field fly ball. And that's hard hit to the gap. And it's going to fall and it's going to go for extra bases. That's the hardest hit ball all day. He's going to go for three. And it's cut off. And a throw to third. It's going to be there. And he's safe. Got under the tag. That was a very close play, but a triple to the gap for Dylan Champagne and a runner at third for the Griffins.
Ooh, man, that ball was absolutely torched.
And he got under that tag.
I mean, that we said nobody would get one to the gap to the wall, but he sure did right there. It looked like the on the relay, maybe a little slip on that relay throw, so probably didn't get as much on it as he would have liked to. Still a bang, bang play. Just got under there for a triple. Another runner in scoring position for the Hahnville Tigers.
And now Fields, breaking ball.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I know what you were saying. The Griffins.
You have to correct me. Sorry.
Yeah. That's all right.
Flustered.
It's all right. I think I still got you 2-1 on the mistakes.
Yeah. I need somebody to be wearing red or something like that.
It's like our spring training game, Mike. But it's been a good one so far. And if Fields can get one to the outfield, that could score a run. Infield playing in, they cannot afford to give up this run right here. Swung and it gets away. It did not make contact, and a run will score. So Champagne makes it 4-1, and they get the 3-run lead back. And it's 2-1 as he swung on that one. What would you call that? That'd be a pass ball right there, maybe? It looked like he may have been able to.
Yeah, it can be a wild pitch. It's got to be a pass ball. Usually, you know, yeah. You can see your wild pitches way up out of the zone or down in the dirt or something like that. So.
Yeah, I thought he could have made that play right there.
It's tough. I mean, you get that swing right there, you know, it kind of obstructs your view.
We've seen him behind the plate, Moyer, He's had a couple in his mitt that got away from him and advanced a couple of runners. So he's had some trouble here today, and that one cost him a run. Counts 3-1. Ball 4. Ooh. And Fields has reached base 3 times today. Base hit and 2 walks. Now Wall, who has not reached, is at the plate. And Teague, we'll see if he gets pulled here. He's done a great job. He righted the ship because it looked like it was about to get, I wouldn't say ugly, but it was about to turn into a big lead for Dutchtown in that second inning before he came and got everything back in order.
Yeah, pitched really well up until that, you know, it made one bad pitch, caught, you know, on that triple. Kind of put yourself in a tough spot, too. You know, when you got that runner on third base with less than 2 outs, I mean, you kind of try to battle. I got to strike this guy out. Got to try to not let him score or whatever. You know, I finally got it within 2 runs. And kind of getting that battle with yourself, trying to figure out how to get that next guy out, and ended up throwing a pass ball and end up walking Fields.
Yep. And Fields is going to stay at first. And he's a wide receiver. You know he has speed.
Now batting for the Griffins, right field number 13, Caleb Wall.
That's a trademark of the Dutchtown players. They're going to run the bases. You got a lot of speedy guys out there, and then you got guys like Mayo coming off the.
Yeah, I feel like Mayo's run. I feel like he's run like every other hitter.
Yeah, he's been coming in for. Yeah, Champagne has been on base 3 times, and I suppose he scored that run.
Yes, he did.
Strike. At the belt. We'll call it the belt. Oh, and 1. And that's low and outside. 1-1. You brought it up many times, and I hear it a lot every time after you have the conference on the mound, pitcher comes back and throws a strike.
Yep, that's usually typically the best pitch to hit.
And excuse me, swing foul off the screen. And count goes to 1-2. There's 1 out. 1 run is already in this inning. Our score 4-1. Champagne tripled, and the courtesy runner Mayo scored on the passed ball. Fields walked. He's at first, and there's the throw. Love that box and box right there. I love it. Couldn't time that one better, my friend. Oh, did he go around?
Yeah, you could hear it.
I thought I heard a foul tip. Yep. There have been several foul tip third strikes. And there's one right there for the second out. So the last 3 outs for T have been strikeouts. Now, Oakwin is going to come to the plate 0-2. Try to extend the inning. Productive inning so far for the Griffins. And the runner's going and protecting him. And that is going to come behind the plate. And the catcher drops it again. Had it in his glove. Wow. Tough day for Moyer, man.
That ball had to be over this press box at one point.
Yeah.
I'm sure it blew back.
Yeah, look at the replay right here.
All the way to the net. He's underneath it. Oh, yeah, just off the heel.
Yep. He's had a tough day. Still early in the season. He's going to get it figured out.
Giving Oakland some new life here.
We'll see what he can do with it. We'll see if Fields is going to go again. He's got a good lead. Looks a little antsy out there. Does not go. Pitch inside.
See Teague right there, kind of switch up his looks right there. It's time to home right there. Typically, you know, you'll see him come set, go get to the plate within 1 or 2 seconds on that one right there. He held just to try to mess up Fields' timing a little bit.
And there's a bouncer to second, and a good bounce to Gregson to throw to Parker. 4-3 for the third out. So they've got a run on a hit. No errors, one left. It's 4-1. Dutchtown leads Pondville as we go to the top of the sixth. You're watching the Rev Game of the Week.
Pondville 1.
As a local provider, we understand the unique challenges and rewards as a Southeast Louisiana business. And we're right here with you, powering your business with local know-how and the unmatched service you deserve. Our internet and managed services are more than connectivity. They're our promise to provide the most important thing every business needs, consistency and quality. We're here to help. For a limited time, get 3 months free. Rev Business. Visit us at letsrev.biz.
The athletic training staff of Dutchtown High School would like to thank Advantage Physical Therapy, FCC Heating and Cooling, Tata Law Firm, Raising Cane's in Prairieville, Ross Downing Buick GMC, Hollis Orthodontics, Baton Rouge Orthopedic Clinic Foundation, Peak Performance Physical Therapy, for their support of our Griffins Sports Medicine Program.
Top of the sixth, Dutchtown 4, Hondville 1, and we are ready to go as Overly has gone through his warm-ups, and we're going to see 2, 3, and 4, Garisco, Terrio, and Gregson for Hondville. And Overly may have had his best inning in the fifth. Had a 1-2-3 fifth inning, and the first pitch to Garisco is a ball. And there's a flare that's going to drop into right field for a softly hit base hit.
That's what we talk about. You don't have to hit them all hard. I mean, that one kind of got on Garisco's hands a little bit. And with the wind blowing in, that ball's never going to make it to right field. Exactly what he's supposed to do. I mean, Hondville's looking for some base runners, find a way to get on, and that's exactly what Garisco did.
So Garisco has flown out. He has been hit by a pitch, and he's got a base hit. Now Terrio, who has struck out and singled. And that's a bouncer at the plate. Foul ball.
Ooh. Hopefully gets that ball back. Usually you see the umpire take that ball.
Yeah.
Foul ball straight to the ground. It's got to have some kind of little scuff on it.
You would think. Got to love it. Feels happy about that.
Yeah.
0-1, fly ball, center field. Mayo is under it, and he makes the catch. So Hondville making contact, got one on base, and then the fly out to center for the first out of the inning.
Now batting second.
Garisco stays at first. Gregson at the plate. Ryan Gregson, the second baseman, flew out and has a base hit. And there's one low. About a 55-foot breaking ball.
Good job by Champagne right there.
Absolutely. I've been impressed with his job catching.
Yeah, typically you don't see, I mean, he comes in, what, he's 6'3" back there, right?
Yeah.
Typically you don't see him that big because it's tough to be mobile.
Right.
But we saw how athletic he was.
And swing and a miss. 1-1. Dutchtown's had some good catchers over the years. You had Ickes a couple of years ago, Barry last year. And Champagne's done it with the bat, and he's done it with the arm. Hardest hit ball, and he's thrown a runner out at second. And a throw to first. No.
2-1, good pitch right there.
Yep. I said it before, you'd swear that this guy was a quarterback.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you love that as a pitcher, like, hey, you want to see your catcher be aggressive, try to pick that guy behind, but man, on that close pitch, don't steal it. Don't, you know, give Give that umpire a little bit longer.
I see your point.
You know, give me a pitch out of the zone that you know is out of the zone. That's the one you would want to try to pick on.
That's a good point.
Not the borderline one, man. He could have got me a strike right there.
So 2-2. Might have cost him that strikeout right there. We'll see. Fouled away toward Griffin Field. The track meet is over.
Yeah. We're all going to have to walk the racetrack to get our vehicles.
Yeah, pretty much. I think I parked in the front office. Of course, Griffin Park and Griffin Field right next to each other. And there's a fly ball to center. Well, Stanford Mayo, yes, he didn't even have to move a foot. Fly ball to center. Mayo's made two outs.
Now batting center hit that ball number on the one, Chase Morales.
Okay, he took maybe one step to his right.
Yeah, but he didn't have to cover any ground. He stepped up one and then back one, so he kind of made up for it.
Great shot there by our camera operators. And now you have Parker trying to extend the inning for the Tigers. Fouled away. Back in our direction. You love purple, you love this game tonight. You'd swear Dutchtown was a home team out there. Of course, they have gold out there as well.
Dutchtown is the home team.
Well, you swear the team play. You know what I meant.
I'm so confused.
Yeah, the team wearing purple is not the home team. That's what I meant to say. 0-2.
Typically or historically, the team with the white unis is always home. But you see that, I don't know, that rule's kind of broken a lot more these days.
Right. Does Dutchtown have a City Connect uniform?
I don't think so.
Yeah, I see those now. Those things are just crazy. 1-2. And that's fouled away behind home plate.
Good battle right here, Morales. Good job right there fighting that pitch off.
Oberle's done a good job after struggling through that fourth inning, giving up a run. And Morales says it hit him. The runner moves on to second. And the umpire arguing with the batter. And looks like the count's going to be 2-2.
Well, I think Morales might have an argument. Might have hurt a little.
It was very close.
A little tick right there.
So they're going to talk to the second base umpire about it.
Which is kind of odd because you know that the home. Oh, never mind.
They're saying that the runner's got to go back to first base, Garisco. The base runner went to second during the discussion. That was
good
not
try.
A stolen base.
Yeah, good try. Love it.
So that was the right decision. It's 2-2, two outs. Oh, fouled hard. Nearly hit a mic back there.
Morales took a healthy hack right there. He wanted to do some damage.
Yep. Morales, 0-2. Now the count is full. So So Parker's on deck.
This Morales is going to be going.
Absolutely.
Going on the pitch here. Trying to get a little head start.
And it's low, and it's a base on balls. And
yeah, I don't know about that. That's a borderline pitch right there.
Yeah,
you got to figure Morales is probably going to get the benefit of the doubt right there. Good job by him right there taking that pitch. I mean,
right.
Sometimes you can get frustrated knowing you kind of got hit.
Yeah.
It should be at first base. And kind of get yourself out of your element, try to maybe expand your, you know, end up expanding the zone. But
yeah,
good patience right there.
You could tell he was a little frustrated. He was a little demonstrative as he went down the first baseline. But everything's cool now. And you have runners at first and second. And it looks like we're going to have a pitching change. As Oberle is going to be done for the night, and we'll have a relief pitcher, and we'll get that after the break. We're going to take a short break right here. You're watching the Rev Game of the Week.
Your business is as unique as Southeast Louisiana. People, culture, family. We know what it means to be local. Rev is the only communications provider with support teams that live and work in the same Louisiana communities that we serve. Customer-first localism is truly in our DNA. Our promise is to bring your business the reliability and local support you deserve. We've been connecting communities in Louisiana for 85 years, and we're ready to serve you and your business. Rev Business.
The athletic training staff of Dutchtown High School would like to thank Advantage Physical Therapy, FCC Heating and Cooling, Tata Law Firm, Raising Cane's in Prairieville, Ross Downing Buick GMC, Hollis Orthodontics, Baton Rouge Orthopedic Clinic Foundation, Peak Performance Physical Therapy, for their support of our Griffins Sports Medicine Program.
And we're back, and got a new pitcher, and that's Max Heintz, who's going to take the place of Jordan Oberle.
Yeah, great job by Oberle right there. I mean, as a starter, you want to get your team deep into the game with a chance to win, right? And he did just that. Yeah, he leaves with two base runners on, but still has two outs. Leaves it. Yikes. That was a razor blade. First pitch from Max Heintz. That thing had some action. Good pitch, slider.
So he gets ahead. Parker, 0-1. Breaking ball. Misses, 1-1. First and second, the tying run is at the plate. 4-1 lead for the Griffins. Swing and a miss, and the throw back to second, and he is safe. It's so close. That was a lot closer than you might have thought.
Good throw right there by Champagne. That ball just a little bit behind the base runner. I think if it's more, a little bit more towards the bag, they got him.
1-2. Strike three. Caught looking. And that's going to do it. And the threat by Hanville is extinguished by Max Heintz. And you had no runs on one hit. And no errors. Two left. Bottom of the sixth inning, our score. Dutchtown 4, Hanville 1. And we're going to talk about some of our games of the week as we move to baseball and softball. And we got a couple of softball games coming up on Tuesday nights.
Yeah, this is our first and it's going to be a while before we do baseball again. I think our next five games maybe are going to be softball, but you see there on March 5th and the week following on March 12th, we'll be doing the softball game, Santa Mall at EA and then Santa Mall at Dutchtown.
And Santa Mall, of course, on the girls' side, back-to-back state champs. You're losing A.J. Jackson, though, and Alex Franklin.
Alex Franklin's back.
She is?
Behind.
Okay, she did come back. Okay, yes, that's right. My bad.
Yep, she's a year behind AJ.
Okay, so got one more year before she goes off and plays college ball. But it's going to be tough replacing a pitcher and home run hitter like A.J. Jackson, but we're going to see over the next 2 weeks how they're going to do in district play.
Yeah, well, I mean, Santa Monica, you talk about it, they probably have a plethora of pitchers.
Absolutely.
That somebody that can, you know, fill right. that void in the circle. They always have somebody just to kind of re-up.
The bottom of the sixth inning.
You got a great team. You got great players, great athletes, and great coach. And we'll see what they can do this season. And of course, we'll see what the other teams in district can do this season as well. It's going to be here in the bottom of the 6-9-1-2, Mayo, McCoy, and Mitchell. And there's one just short and a little slide right there. Done with a little style.
Ooh. Breaking ball. Pitch. Ball just got an update elsewhere. Top of five, you got the Dunham Tigers 4 and Santa Monica Gators 1. That game's being played at Santa Monica this evening.
Bit of a surprise. None of the Ascension Parish teams have lost this season so far. This accounts 3-0.
And I know East Ascension's off because I see all three of their coaches in the stands here a little bit earlier.
You know they're scouting and they play tomorrow. Ball 4. And so we got a Mayo on base.
Yeah.
Shot
they're everywhere. Now this Mayo already has a stolen base tonight. This is Logan, not Ryland. Ryland is the courtesy runner for Champaign. McCoy at the plate. Strike called. Teague has only given up one run. The first three were credited to the starter, Hayden.
It's another good pitch right
Absolutely.
There.
Absolutely.
Man, it's tough.
Just so close. McCoy's got a couple of walks on the day.
I misspoke. That Dunham Santa Mar game is actually at Dunham, not at Santa Mar.
Strike two.
You get that pitch. I think that one was maybe six to eight inches outside. Looked like from here.
It looked like it. But the Hondo pitcher's been getting that spot, maybe not that far out, but he's been getting that outside spot a lot. Mayu still not going. There he goes. Fouled away.
I like that. Good pitch to run on right there. 1-2. Got to think maybe Teague's going to come in with maybe a breaking ball in the dirt, try to get a swing and miss chase, which would be the best pitch to steal on.
Just fouled away. McCoy got two walks and a pop out to first base. And they're going to check in and see if he's leaning.
Yeah, not his best one over there to first base, Teague. Just kind of, hey, I know you're over there. I just saw you try to run. Kind of keep you honest. Make you think I might be coming right here with my best move.
It's 1-2. Ah, 2-2. McCoy has done a good job drawing two strike walks here today. Started off in the first inning with an 0-2 count and got the base on balls and scored a run.
Yeah, I mean, exactly what you want from your leadoff hitter, right?
Right.
See some pitches.
He's going again, and it gets away, and that's that breaking ball. Good timing, right?
Picked a great pitch to run on right there. That's using your head on the bases right there. You see him just elevate a fastball before. You know he's probably not going to try to get him out with that pitch the next time. He's going to try to change eye levels, even speeds.
And he got a swing and a miss. And that's the first strikeout for McCoy. So now one out, runner at second.
Now
Mayo.
For the Griffin, second
and
now
Kobe Mitchell.
Mitchell.
He's got a single. A single here could score a run. He also has a sacrifice bunt. and a grounder to second. It's a big hole between short and third. Now the shortstop gets back. Beauty. Breaking ball. 0-1. 0-1-3. Swing at that outside pitch. Now 0-2. Four to one, and again, just impressed with Teague. Hayden gave up three in the first. Inherited two base runners in the second, then Teague came in. And he's only given up one run. Ball high. 1-2. There is action in the pen. He's thrown a lot of pitches at this point. Fouled away. One and two. One out. Runner at second. And that's out of play.
Hung a breaking ball right there. Had Mitchell out in front. Sure, that's a pitch you would like to have back. That ball was up in the zone.
The wind has kind of changed directions. Been talking about that for a while. A moment ago, it was blowing out to dead center. It looks like it's going more towards center. Breaking ball outside. It's more towards center, left center, I guess.
Yeah, good take right there by Mitchell. That ball's just off the plate. Good breaking ball.
Fouled away. A little comedy out there from the stands. The students having fun out there. Maybe that's a freshman and JV team out there too. Fouled away. Fighting.
Good battle. Good battle. A couple fastballs up in the zone right there. Those are typically a little tough to get to. Mitchell doing a good job.
Carter Hanbury.
To see another pitch.
Carter Hanbury's on deck. Oh, that's a beauty. Frozen.
Yeah, locked him up. Started that one on the inside half right there.
Now batting for
the So it's going to be up to Hanbury to see if they can get one more insurance run.
Great pitch by Teague right there.
Hanbury has not fared well with Teague. Teague has won the first two battles. Strikeout, strikeout. Ball. Hanbury reached on a fielder's choice and scored a run. Then he scored himself on DeSherry's triple. And now, pitcher, you got to be close to maxing out on pitches.
Yeah, his pitch count's got to be pretty elevated now. Maybe just give him a little break.
So we move into the seventh. Dutchtown will have a lead, so if Dutchtown can get Hanville in the seventh, that would be it.
Well, he's going to leave him in the face. Probably just gave him a little breather right there. That was a good battle with Mitchell. threw a lot of pitches, and like we said, you know, his pitch count's got to be pretty elevated now.
Yep. So he's going to come back with a strike. Yeah. If your theory is correct.
Let's see.
Oh.
No. Oh, he's laboring.
Mm-hmm. Ball two. The Sherry's on deck. 054. First base is open. And Hanbury wants to get that base hit. And if you learned anything from football season, this guy's a competitor, and he's struck out the last two times. He's got a chance to redeem himself right here, and he wants it. He doesn't want to go 0-for-3 against Teague. Bouncer. 3-1. Chased it. That's ball four. But he went around.
Yeah, he's chomping at the bit right there. Saw that ball up in the zone, man. It looked good. Just couldn't pull the trigger.
Good shot right there. You see DeSherry on deck. And DeSherry's going to come to the plate. As Hanbury walks.
Now batting for the Griffins, first baseman number 10, Dylan DeSherry.
So now DeSherry's got a chance to be the hero, and now we're going to – now he's not going
to
make it.
Yep, I have to have a pitching change.
Yep. So we're going to see a new pitcher momentarily. Let's just stay with the conference right now. It's 4-1. Griffins with the lead. And two runners on base when the new pitcher comes in. And it was a great job by Teague, but
yeah,
he's done.
Yeah, job there. I mean, Coach Vial's got to be extremely happy with what he just did for his team. I mean, you come in the second inning and get your team all the way to the bottom of the sixth, just shy of getting through that sixth inning. It's exactly what you need.
So pitching change, and we'll take a break. You're watching the Rev Game of the Week.
Now pitching for the Tigers, number 27.
Your business is as unique as Southeast Louisiana. People, culture, family. We know what it means to be local. Rev is the only communications provider with support teams that live and work in the same Louisiana communities that we serve. Customer-first localism is truly in our DNA. Our promise is to bring your business the reliability and local support you deserve. We've been connecting communities in Louisiana for 85 years, and we're ready to serve you and your business. Rev Business.
Welcome back to Griffin Park here at Dutchtown High School, and it's 4-1. Dutchtown leads Hanville. Jeff Porsche, Mike Moeller with you. And the pitching change, Teague is out, and the new pitcher is Albert Liu, L-I-U.
Liu tasked with the job to come in and get one more out, try to get that Tiger team back in that dugout so they can try to scratch a couple of runs across in the top half of that seventh inning. What you can't let happen if you're Liu right here is let this inning snowball.
And you got DeSherry at the plate. DeSherry's already tripled. And if he reaches base, you got Champagne on deck, or Champagne, and he tripled.
Now
he tripled too. You had both guys.
Right.
He had one
DeSherry.
Triple to DeSherry with that little dying ball to right field, and then you had the one to the gap from Champagne. So pick your poison. Base hit's going to score a run with two outs. And with Mayo at second with two bags on the day. Carter Hanbury's at first. He drew the walk.
He scored on that triple in the first inning, too.
He doesn't look like he can run, but
He can run.
He had a 98-yard touchdown run during football season.
I called it 105 because he took the pitch about 5 yards deep in the end zone and took it to the house.
And there's a ball, 1-1. And Lou steps away. And the Sherry likes to play with those batting gloves.
Nomar Garcia Parra.
Yep. And there's a bouncer to short. Good stop. The throw to first. And it gets away.
Oh, wow.
And the run is going to score. And so may have to call that one an error. I don't know. That's a tough one. But regardless, Mayo scores when the ball gets away from Parker at first base.
That was a great play by Terry. I thought he was going to kind of pivot and throw to second base to get the short out. But sure enough, made a good throw to first base right there. Just a little bit shy. Short hop Parker not able to come up with it.
So it's 5-1. We'll wait for the official scorekeeper. Find out what Ted has to say. Strike call.
He gave it a hit.
So that's a base hit. So DeSherry gets another base hit. Infield single. Runner at third. And there's a slow bouncer to third, Jeffrey to first, and that's the third out. So 5-3 for the third out, and a run scores
on
a base hit. And you have two left on base. So
we
go to the seventh. It's 5-1 Dutchtown. You're watching the Rev game of the week.
As a local provider, we understand the unique challenges and rewards as a Southeast Louisiana business. And we're right here with you, powering your business with local know-how and the unmatched service you deserve. Our internet and managed services are more than connectivity. They're our promise to provide the most important thing every business needs, consistency and quality. We're here to help. For a limited time, get 3 months free. Rev Business. Visit us at letsrev.biz.
The athletic training staff of Dutchtown High School would like to thank Advantage Physical Therapy, FCC Heating and Cooling, Tata Law Firm, Raising Cane's in Prairieville, Ross Downing Buick GMC, Hollis Orthodontics, Baton Rouge Orthopedic Clinic Foundation, Peak Performance Physical Therapy, for their support of our Griffins Sports Medicine Program.
So top of the seventh, and Dutchtown with the insurance run has a 5-1 lead, and you're going to see the bottom of the order for Hanville. Romero and Lou are a pinch hitter, and Jeffrey. And Dutchtown, if they can get three more outs, they'll get the victory. And they're going to be moving on to district play later on this season, and it's a tough district in 5-5A. And they got their work cut out for them.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about it again when the districts or the teams actually changed a couple of years
leading
back.
Leading off, the top of the seventh inning.
You kind of get the Woodlawns and McKinley's out. And you get
number 12,
the Live Oaks Walkers in Denver Springs. Got to be one of the top districts. And, you know, you talk about that district out in, Barb and Sulphur and Sam Houston and those guys. I mean, I think this district can rival that.
Right. And like you said, you don't have those couple of teams that you can almost guarantee a couple of wins, and so that kind of changes how you have to manage your rotation and all that type of stuff as well.
Sure.
As you have a ball.
Yeah, ball up and away. Try to overcook that breaking ball right there. Flew open a little bit.
So it's 2-1. Romero. swing and a miss.
Good pitch right there. In on his hands tight. When you go into those lefties, you want to get it, you know, at least belt high. That's the pitch that's going to tie him up.
Oh, and that's up the middle.
That one didn't get in quite enough.
Nope. That nearly got Max Heinz.
Yeah, that ball leaked back out over the plate. Good job by Romero getting the barrel to it.
Now, Heinz came in and got the strikeout to end the sixth inning, but his second batter that he's faced gets on base, and now we're going to have, looks like a pinch hitter, number 15 coming to the plate.
Colin Dotto.
So Dotto comes to the plate. Strike call. Runner at first, Romero. It's a four-run lead. Dutchtown doesn't have to worry about him too much. And a ball. Heinz in relief of Oberle. And there's a ball, 2-1 to count. So Cohen Dano, okay, is at the plate. And a throwback to first. No. And the count 2-2, so Dano.
See, I'm good with that right there. That ball's up. You get a swing at that one. That's a good pitch to try to throw behind that runner at first base.
That makes a lot of sense. And that's a walk. Actually, it was three balls. So now things get a little spicy, I guess, as you have the 7 and 8 hitters reach base, and now you have the number 9 hitter. This is Jeffrey. Struck out and popped out. It's a 4-run lead. I don't think they'd be sacrificing an out right
now. Running at first base, number 4, Brad Matero. Now batting third baseman, number 3, Jacob Jeffrey.
First and second. Breaking ball does not break enough. 1-0. And it gets away from Champagne, and now it's second and third. Things getting interesting.
Well, one of the toughest things for a relief pitcher is when you come in and jam late in the game and you get out of it, you know, there's a lot of intensity right there. You get yourself out, sometimes you tend to kind of exhale. I don't want to say let your guard down or whatever, but when you go back in there, bases are empty, you know, not quite the focus or the concentration. Sometimes you just unintentionally let your guard down. Because the situation isn't, you know, as crucial.
Gotcha. Well, Troy Tomplay is going to try to right the ship here.
All right. Visit to the mound. Let's see.
Yeah, we're 1-for-2 right now.
See if we can hit 67.
Yep. He needs to, or else he's going to fall behind 3-0, and then he's going to have to throw a strike. It's a number 9 hitter. And taking all the way, even though he had the square.
2-0 breaking ball there. It just tells me he's a little more confident with that pitch right now than he is his fastball.
They just walked the number 9 hitter.
4 straight.
And at that point, you're not going to get the benefit of the doubt on that pitch.
Yeah, no, when you miss, you know, if you're close and you're throwing some strikes every now and then, you're going to get those borderline pitches.
Truman Moyer.
And now the tying run is at the plate, top of the order, the catcher, Truman Moyer.
If you're Hornville, this is exactly what you need to do. This is exactly, you know, you're down 5-1. You can't ask for a better situation than you're in right now.
And now he gets the breaking ball strike. Check on the wind, not blowing as hard as it was, but it's still blowing out to left. And you got a righty up. Breaking ball miss. 5-1, but the bases are loaded and nobody is out. A little hairy situation right now for the Griffins. One beauty. Taking all the way. Moyer has been an impatient batter. He's jumped on first pitches earlier. Now he's taking one right down the street. Oh, I got away from him, and there's no play at the plate as the run scores. There was a throw, but he got there easily. And it's 5-2.
That low breaking ball looked like it squirted out pretty bad.
Yeah,
close, way behind.
Yeah, he definitely lost the handle on that one. Got out early. And there's a fly to center, and it's caught by Mayo. Runner holds at third as they get that in quickly.
Yeah, good job there all the way around. I mean, I don't think you're still down by three runs, right?
Right.
I mean, what good does it do to take the chance of?
That makes sense.
You know, getting thrown out.
Now batting left fielder number 21, home right there. Caleb Garisco.
So Garisco is at the plate.
Mayo does everything fundamentally correct right there. Catch the ball, get it in. Don't overthrow your cutoff, man.
And there's a strike. Now remember, the tying run is still at the plate. It's 5-2 Dutchtown. But a lefty can't take advantage of that wind so much. Inside. 1-1, one out. Second and third. Missed. Been getting the breaking balls on the righties, but the outside on the lefty, not working right there.
Yeah, didn't quite finish that one right there. Sometimes that lefty kind of closes you off. You tend to not finish that breaking ball. That's a good one right there.
Absolutely. Now it's 2-2. So after Tomplay came in, he finished that batter with the walk. He's come back strong. 2-2. One out. Base hit, and it may have hit Heinz, and one run scores, and the other runner holds at third, and it's 5-3, and now the tying run is at first base, and the go-ahead run is at the plate.
Woo. Good job right there by Garisco. Didn't try to do too much, right? Spin the ball.
Right.
He knows he's getting a slider. Because obviously Heinz doesn't feel real good about his fastball right now. So I'm sure the talk in the dugout is, hey, look for a breaking pitch in the zone and you're going to get one, right? Shot it right back up the middle. Typically you'll see somebody try to do too much, get out in front a little bit and roll that over. But Garisco just shot it right back up where it was. Where it came from.
And Heinz is not going to finish the game. Had his problems here in the seventh. Was able to get out of a jam in the sixth to his credit, but just didn't have it here in the seventh inning. We're going to keep it here as we change pitchers and see if Dutchtown can hold on. It was 5-1, and now it's 5-3. So, Mike, that run that scored on the base hit that was misplayed by the first baseman, that scored a run. That's a big run now at this point, right?
I mean, yeah, you look at the line score, on the scoreboard out there, Dutchtown gets three early, then held in check by Teague for the next three, and he pick up an insurance run, which they thought was important, just to get him the fourth run after Holmville scratches for one, and then they pick up an extra one in the bottom of the sixth, which is turning out to be really big.
Yep. And we're going to see Casey McCoy close this out, I believe. That's exactly what it is. We didn't see him pitch much last season. He was the full-time shortstop. So we'll see who comes in and plays shortstop. But okay, so
now at second base, number 15, Maddox Woodward.
Yeah, okay, there we go. So Maddox Woodward is going to
touchdown. Number 7, Casey McCoy.
And McCoy will, so really no changes to the batting order. And we'll see if Casey McCoy can put out the fire. We talked about him being the Raging Cajun commitment. He's a junior. He'll be in Lafayette in a couple of years. And the first pitch misses, and it's 1-0 to Talon Terrio. Extra bases could tie this game. There's a breaking ball beauty. 1-1. Now a double play ball could end it. And fouled weakly to the screen. 1-2.
Does sound a little fortunate on that last play. You see Mayo come in, throw that ball. Probably could have thrown that to second base, right? The first
right.
Run at first base is a tying run. That's a guy you want to keep in check.
There's a fly ball. Mayo's got it. Runner tagging. It's 5-4. Runner stays at first. So sack fly to center. And one more out, and Dutchtown can survive this one. As it's going to be
now
the cleanup hitter,
two, Ryan Gregson.
Ryan Gregson, who has a base hit today in 3 at-bats. He's a righty. He's hitting cleanup, so he's probably got some power. So a dangerous situation. McCoy to face Gregson. With the ball game on the line, a breaking ball strike. Five to four. Three runs for Hanville in the seventh so far. Outside, 1-1. Runner at first, tying run. Missed.
Just off the dish. Great take right there if you're Gregson.
Yep.
McCoy would have loved to have that pick.
Absolutely. 1-1. Excuse me.
That's a good pitch.
Yep. 2-2.
My goodness.
That was about the faintest strike call.
That was not a strike. He did not call that a strike, did he?
He did. Hey, he called it 2-2. He put up 2-2.
Oh, he did.
He did put up 2-2, I swear. Oh, well, but it doesn't matter.
The umpire did?
Yeah, I saw the umpire put up 2-2.
Uh-oh, that's a tying run.
So that's
at
a tying run
here.
At second base. Well, so that was confusing. I swear I saw him put up
2-2. I saw him tap champagne kind of on the back there and kind of said, look, it was outside, but I didn't see what he put up.
Yeah, but
Now running at second base.
Now you got
number 13,
Morales.
Bennett Nockhand
coming to the plate.
Now batting.
Base runner Nockhand, the go-ahead run.
Center fielder number one.
They were no
good
up in this Homeville Tiger team, huh?
Oh God, no!
Right until the end, coming this last inning down 5-1, threatening to tie it up right now.
Facing Casey McCoy. Oh, nearly hit him. Ball one. Right.
That's a good pitch. I thought the pitch before that was a strike too. See, Morales is all over the dish right here. You see his feet on the white line.
And a fisted foul.
Kind of emergency swing right there.
Yeah.
Typically you see that swing with two strikes. I think that kind of surprised Morales. That ball ran in on his hands.
One and two. And this is the loudest it's been here at the park. Swing and a miss, and Dutchtown wins it. And eight batters come to the plate in the seventh inning. Three runs score.
And
it's not enough.
Game, ladies and gentlemen, your final score.
Dutchtown
wins. Dutchtown 5, Homeville 4.
By a score of 5-4, we'll take a quick break and come back and wrap things up. You're watching the Rev Game of the Week.
Your business is as unique as Southeast Louisiana. People, culture, family. We know what it means to be local. Rev is the only communications provider with support teams that live and work in the same Louisiana communities that we serve. Customer-first localism is truly in our DNA. Our promise is to bring your business the reliability and local support you deserve. We've been connecting communities in Louisiana for 85 years, and we're ready to serve you and your business. Rev Business.
B.T. Chapman and A.J. Pickett with Advantage Therapy are honored and excited to team up with Dutchtown High School's athletics. At Advantage Therapy, we are dedicated to helping our patients regain the highest possible functional status through one-on-one patient care. Advantage Therapy has spent nearly two decades providing both outpatient orthopedic physical therapy and occupational therapy to the people of Ascension and surrounding parishes. From all of us at Advantage Therapy, go Griffins!
It's game day at Raising Cane's. If you want to order like a champ, forget about X's and O's. The only play you're running is chicken. So what combo are you picking? We've got tailgates of hand-battered, cooked-to-order chicken fingers and cane sauce. Touchdown! And jugs of freshly made tea and lemonade. This season is about to be unbeatable. Raising Cane's Chicken Fingers. One love.
Dr. Brian Hollis is Ascension Parish's orthodontist. Dr. Hollis has an excellent reputation for bringing state-of-the-art technology and the highest standard of patient care to Ascension. He attended LSU, LSU Dental School, and he completed a residency to become a board-certified specialist in orthodontics. An avid supporter in our community, Dr. Hollis is married to Celeste Pyra Hollis, and they have four children. Dr. Hollis, Ascension Parish's orthodontist. Grow up smiling with Hollis Orthodontics.
Get to know SEC Heating and Cooling this year. Locally owned and operated by Stephen Conyer since 2013, SEC Heating and Cooling works with residential and commercial customers in Ascension, East Baton Rouge, Livingston, and surrounding parishes. SEC specializes in preventive maintenance, repair, and complete changeout and installation of energy-efficient central air systems. From professional sales and expert installation of central AC systems to repairs and ductless AC systems, we can handle all your needs. For total peace of mind, call SEC today.
No one teaches you what to do immediately after an accident. Once everyone is safe, your first call should be to an attorney, not the insurance company.
Don't let the insurance company take advantage of you at your time of need. Call the Tata Law Firm. We'll walk you through what you need to do in real time.
But you can take advantage of the Tata Law Firm's 30 years of experience.
Before you call your insurance, make a free, no-obligation call to the Tata Law Firm.
Call 756-0007 when you're injured. You gotta call. You gotta call Tata.
Looking for an extraordinary education opportunity? Introducing Ascension Public School's Early College Option Program, where you can earn a high school diploma and an associate's degree from River Parish's Community College at the same time. Experience the best of both worlds as high school seamlessly blends with college coursework in a rigorous yet supportive program. Yet stay connected to your home high school through clubs, organizations, and sports. And here's the best part. Students pay no tuition or textbook costs. Ascension Public School's Early College Option Program, where your future begins today.
As a local provider, we understand the unique challenges and rewards as a Southeast Louisiana business. And we're right here with you, powering your business with local know-how and the unmatched service you deserve. Our internet and managed services are more than connectivity. They're our promise to provide the most important thing every business needs, consistency and quality. We're here to help. For a limited time, get 3 months free. Rev Business. Visit us at letsrev.biz.
And welcome back. As you see, Coach Shake talking to his team. Dutchtown had the 5-1 lead going into the seventh. Hanville fought back, made it 5-4, but Casey McCoy comes in and saves it for Jordan Oberle, who gets the win for the Griffins, and Dutchtown remains undefeated on the season, Mike.
Yeah, great game. I mean, on both sides, Dutchtown jumps out to an early 3-0 lead. Could have been a lot more than that. Landon Teague comes in for Hanville, shuts it down for the next 3-plus innings. Dutchtown scratches for a couple insurance runs there in the fifth and the sixth. Goes into that last inning, like you said, up 5-1, but no quit from the Hanville Tigers. You see them kind of threaten all the way up to get it to 5-4 with the runner, time running. Scoring position, Casey McCoy shuts him down with a strikeout to end the game.
And so next week we'll be covering softball. We'll have softball for the next couple of weeks on the Rev Game of the Week on Tuesday night, so join us for that. And I'd like to thank everybody, Lyle Boudreaux, our producer at home, Andre Chapoy, our director, and then Jake, Courtney, and Nolan, our camera operators, and, of course, our interns here at Dutchtown helping us out here, as they always do. Great job tonight for everybody. Dutchtown wins 5-4. We'll see you next week. I'm Jeff Porsche. He's Mike Moeller. You've been watching the Rev Game of the Week.